Vitorin.
With Kellen Clemens still hobbled by rib and shoulder injuries suffered against New England last Sunday, Chad Pennington, who came on in relief, will likely get the start this Sunday against Tennessee. He hasn't started a game since the Jets' October 28th loss to Buffalo.
Closing number today, 291. The Patriots have outscored their opponents by 291 points this season. That's 1 point shy of the NFL single-season record set by the 1942 Bears. Once again, the breaking news late into SportsCenter tonight. The U.S. Attorney's Office unsealed former Major League pitcher Jason Grimsley's sworn statement to a federal agent made in May of 2006. Roger Clemens, Andy Pettit, not mentioned in the statement. However, one big name mentioned in the statement, not included in the Mitchell report, Sammy Sosa.
Fastball, he struck it out swinging, and the Boston Red Sox have won the World Series. For the second time in the last 4 years. And the celebration begins right in front of the mound at Coors Field in Denver. They come pouring out of the dugout to jump on top of Jonathan Papelbon,
whose dog then celebrated later. The dog ate my homework. Do you buy the dog ate the World Series ball, the ball used to strike out the final batter? That's what Papelbon says happened.
Yeah, I'm not buying it at all, and nor should you. Basketball's next. Thanks for watching.
Welcome to ESPN's Holiday Hoops, presented by K Jewelers.
New York City is all lit up for the holidays, but the lights will shine brightest in this town tonight inside Madison Square Garden, a matchup of two undefeated teams. Yeah, the Panthers are 10-0, but so is the opposition tonight. The Duke Blue Devils playing their annual pre-Christmas game here in the New York City area. It's a sellout here inside Madison Square Garden tonight. There are a lot of alumni and fans of Duke here, but remember, this is Big East country, and Pittsburgh's had a lot of success in this building as well over the last 6 or 7 years. This figures to be an entertaining night of college basketball here inside the Garden. Hi, everybody. Dan Shulman and Jay Bilas with you. And, Jay, whether you look at the records, the rankings, the atmosphere, this is going to be a lot of fun.
It's a heavyweight fight between two teams with winning cultures. This is a game that's going to simulate an Elite Eight, a great atmosphere. And as Mike Krzyzewski told his team when they're shoot around today, this is a man's game, and there are going to be a lot of men on the court. Pittsburgh very methodical and physical. Duke likes to spread it and drive. It'll be really interesting to watch how each team handles the other's strengths.
Both teams are very balanced, but don't let that fool you. There are a lot of stars on both teams tonight as we take Jay back to the Star Watch.
Well, for Pittsburgh, DeJuan Blair, a freshman, 6'7" tall and a load inside. He has great hands, great feet, and for Duke, their lone senior, DeMarcus Nelson, can put it on the floor and attack the rim. Perhaps their great defender, their best defender, out on the perimeter with his long arms and athleticism.
Time now for tonight's starting lineups presented by Dish Network, and we begin with Pittsburgh, 10-0 for the fifth year in a row, and so much success in recent years in this building. The junior Levance Fields, along with a senior Ronald Ramon, in the backcourt and up front, DeJuan Blair, of whom Jay just spoke, surrounded by Sam Young, having a breakout season, and another senior in Mike Cook. 4-2. Three guys on the perimeter, Greg Paulus, Gerald Henderson, and DeMarcus Nelson, the lone senior, and he's the captain of the Blue Devils up front. Lance Thomas back from a sprained ankle, and one of the outstanding freshmen in the country, Kyle Singler. An outstanding group of officials here tonight, Jim Burr, Mike Kitts, and Jamie Lucky, and we are set for basketball here in the Garden. We expect most of the fans to be supporting Duke, although we know Pittsburgh sold out their allotment of tickets. Pittsburgh plays here every year in the Big East Tournament. They often play St. John's here during the regular season. Mike Krzyzewski told us earlier today, we play here a lot, but this might be the only time when the other team has more experience in this building. And right off the bat, we've got a clock malfunction.
Clock not starting. Duke starting off in man-to-man, though. Just didn't get him for very long.
Mike Krzyzewski really likes this team, and he has for the moment. This group, this trio of freshmen, Jay, came in. They're deeper, they're more athletic, more quick, quicker than they were last year. And Jamie Dixon, his fifth year, 10-0 for the fifth consecutive season. And maybe back in year one, year two, you could look at the non-conference schedule and say, well, they've got to make it tougher. Well, they are starting to make it tougher.
There's no question. Pittsburgh is playing now all comers. They're going on the road. They are having teams come into the Peterson Center. And they are playing a really challenging non-conference schedule to get them ready for the postseason. It's a program that Ben Howland built along with Jamie Dixon. And now Jamie Dixon has done a magnificent job over the last few years.
They've won at Washington. They've beaten Oklahoma State. They're going to Dayton. And again, the clock's not working. They took 6 seconds off it. But when play resumed, the clock didn't budge again. And already the fans are booing.
Well, everybody was ready to play, and, yeah. And this is a game, Dan, you can't just come ready to play. You've got to come ready to fight. So I know it's a little bit of a letdown for the players. They've got to get together and keep their energy up.
Jim Burr's trying to sort it out over there. DeJuan Blair, all kinds of personality, has never been to the Garden until today. Pittsburgh's got a lot of New York City area kids, but Blair is not among them. He's a Pittsburgh product, the first in a number of years to play for that program. Now 10-0, as we mentioned, and an impressive scoring margin for the Pitt Panthers. This is a little bit of a different team, a lot of a different team, than you've come to associate with Pittsburgh in recent years. Aaron Gray's gone, Levon Kendall's gone, along with Antonio Graves in the backcourt. But Pittsburgh also is smaller and quicker than recent Panther teams.
A much more athletic team, much more versatile. And when you've got Sam Young playing the four spot, that provides a lot of matchup difficulties.
Save that Sam Clancy story for a little bit later.
Exactly. Mismatch inside with Paulus guarding DeJuan Blair.
And DeJuan Blair smiling early as he drops in the first bucket of the night.
DeJuan Blair is going to be very difficult for Duke to guard, especially if they're going to switch so many screens.
Henderson doesn't get the bounce. Blair with a rebound. He's 6'7", 265. A year ago, weighed in excess of 300 pounds and was considered to be fairly quick and athletic then.
Lost a lot of weight. Looks much better in a swimsuit now as well.
And the guy, when we walked into the building for the Pittsburgh shoot-around, he came in and just started hollering right away, "It's the Garden!" And he was very excited to play in this building for the first time.
Well, he got Greg Paulus on his hip. Paulus having to switch off after Blair set a screen out on the perimeter. Duke deciding to switch some of those screens.
The athleticism of Henderson on display early.
Well, that is something that Pittsburgh is going to have to do a much better job on. You can't have a handoff and a player turn the corner, get all the way to the basket with no one stepping in to take a charge.
All kinds of interesting matchups, because really anybody on the court can be the go-to scorer on any given night for either one of these teams.
And you can see Sam Young slipping that ball screen right there to get a wide open three. He just missed it. Here's the handoff, little screen off the handoff, off the dribble weave. And Gerald Henderson getting to the basket much too easily.
That's something that Pittsburgh has not let opponents do in recent years, but again, this is a different kind of a Pittsburgh team. Got an offensive foul going against the Blue Devils. Well, Mike Krzyzewski's team, like Jamie Dixon's, is also 10-0. They've had some impressive wins. They won the Maui Invitational with a terrific win over Marquette in the championship game, a tournament you saw. How impressive have the Blue Devils been so far?
They've been outstanding. They're playing a little bit differently this year. They're running some of the Phoenix Suns break options. Instead of crossing underneath on the break, they send their wings to the corner, and it really spreads out. They're using the last 6 to 8 feet of the baseline very effectively, and they're harder to guard as a result of it.
A travel on Ramon, and for the first time in a number of years, Duke's got enough healthy bodies. They can actually go 5-on-5 with scholarship players in practice. It's something that the public doesn't see, but boy, do the coaches value having enough bodies in practice.
Well, being able to have competitive practices makes any team better.
Nelson will go to the line. Two of the most successful programs in recent memory, Duke and Pitt. Duke has been to the Sweet 16 five of the last 6 years. That's the most of any program in the country. Pittsburgh has been there four of the last 6 years. I guess the big difference, Jay, is Pittsburgh has not been able to get beyond the Sweet 16.
That's the step I think the Pittsburgh program is looking to take. During the regular season, they have been magnificent. They've been outstanding in Big East play, not only in regular season Big East play, but also in the tournament. It's the NCAA tournament, though, that we all seem to value as putting the stamp on true greatness. And they've just been one step away, seemingly, each year.
Had Duke won their game with Virginia Commonwealth in the first round of the NCAA tournament a year ago, they would have played Pitt. But Pitt then beat VCU to get to the Sweet 16, where they lost to UCLA. Levance Fields trying to push it against Greg Paulus.
You see Duke switching the screens. Switching that dribble weave and switching screens. So they're going to have some mismatches. It's going to be up to Pittsburgh to try to determine those mismatches, read them, and exploit them.
Pittsburgh is generally not a team that commits a lot of turnovers. They don't rush offensively. Do they look a little unsettled to you in the early going?
I think both teams are trying to feel each other out right now. I mean, we haven't seen anybody really take off yet. Well, look at the great hands of DeJuan Blair.
And a foul is called on Henderson, but Blair had one thing in mind, and that was ripping down the rim.
Blair leads this Pittsburgh team in steals. 2.4 steals per game. That's extraordinary for a big guy. He probably should have given the ball up to Levance Fields, who was ahead of him and had probably had an easier layup. But this is a young man who couldn't be more excited, and he wanted to punch it and send a message in the Garden that Pittsburgh was ready to compete at the highest level. Well, you talk about it being a man's game. That was a man's meeting at the summit right there. He just couldn't complete the play.
Blair out of Schenley High in Pittsburgh. And again, the first notable player from Pittsburgh to go play for the Panthers in a number of years. It's a city that is football crazy, and it just hasn't turned out many high-caliber talents in recent years.
You know, and he's always got a smile on his face, DeJuan Blair, and I don't think anybody is strong enough to knock it off his face.
Terrific player. And somehow that pass snaked its way through to Thomas, but then he lost it out of bounds.
Well, you got to give Sam Young a lot of credit there for active hands. It's one thing to be in the right position. It's another thing to have hands active and go after the ball without fouling. That's what Young did.
Duke will extend the defense, pick up full court from time to time. Pittsburgh more of a tough half-court offense kind of team.
That's a set that Pittsburgh likes to run. Little ball screen, bring Ramon off the other side, off a staggered double, and Duke switched that screen with Lance Thomas out front and kept it to one side. They eliminated the possibility of moving it side to side. Solid by Duke.
You saw the numbers for Sam Young. Biggest difference, in addition to the arrival of DeJuan Blair, the health of Sam Young, and he has taken his game where many thought it might have gone a couple of years ago.
Duke running their elbow series.
Singler over Young, uses the glass.
Well, Sam Young did a pretty darn good job defensively to move his feet and make Kyle Singler shoot over. But you can see, Dan, Kyle Singler has no holes in his game. He is a complete player, even as a freshman, and just an outstanding performer that doesn't need the ball to play, never forces anything.
And how about a freshman going out to Maui in that caliber of tournament and winning the MVP? Almost another turnover. Pittsburgh has already kicked it away four times.
Kyle Singler getting the ball on the elbow, facing up. Very good footwork, puts it on the floor with his left hand and absorbs a little bit of a bump and still completes the play using the window. Just an extraordinary player that was a high school quarterback, a terrific skills athlete.
Lance Thomas out. John Shire, who's coming off the bench this year for Duke, will come in as Singler, a little too aggressive with Blair, and he's called for the foul.
Well, Blair is just so strong, and he's got a great feel. Terrific feet and terrific hands.
Indiana was interested in Blair, Tennessee, Kansas State, among others, but he decided to stay home and attend Pitt. And with the loss of Aaron Gray and Levon Kendall up front, they needed some size. And Blair's a much different kind of a player than Aaron Gray is or was with Pittsburgh, but he has given them a real spark. Young steps in, a little floater's too strong.
He was worried about getting a charge there.
Paul is pushing it. Henderson. And Henderson called for the foul. That'll be number two on Gerald Henderson.
Just out of control, trying to push the tempo in transition. And Levance Fields very intelligently gets in front and uses great patience to draw that charge. You know, that's the play of a veteran right there in Levance Fields. And, you know, Levance Fields, you talk about him, you know, having maybe a street game. He doesn't have a street game. He's got a 3.5-to-1 assist turnover ratio. That is absolutely extraordinary. What a great guard.
So Henderson out, as you saw. Taylor King, another freshman, a guy with unlimited shooting range, comes into the game for Duke. A switch now, King on Ramon.
Pitt's going to have to try to take advantage, and they post Young inside.
Taking advantage of Shire.
Anytime there's a mismatch, the pressure is going to have to be on the ball to take away vision, because Shire cannot guard Young down in that low post.
So Duke will most often switch on the screens?
Well, they may have to adjust because they've got burned a couple times. Great slip off the ball screen. Good job by Singler coming out, setting the ball screen, seeing that his man got above him, and immediately slipping to the basket.
Second field goal of the night for Kyle Singler, 6'8 freshman out of Medford, Oregon, along with Kevin Love, the co-player of the year in the state of Oregon last year.
But to have that kind of talent coming out of the state of Oregon is extraordinary.
And neither one they were able to keep within state of the college ranks. Love, of course, playing for UCLA. Here's Ramon off to Sam Young, and he missed the jam.
Well, he was trying to knock that through the wood.
Well, Blair missed one earlier, but at least got to the line. Sam Young trying to throw it down, and everybody may be a little bit over-amped here to begin this game in the Garden.
Send it out.
Coming to DVD, Carter and Lee are back. In the biggest rush of them all.
I'm Hot Black, and I'm fly.
You down with that, Snoopy?
Sorry, Lee, you can't be black. There's a height requirement.
Chris Tucker, Jackie Chan.
Violence will solve nothing.
Whoa! Rush Hour 3, directed by Brett Ratner.
I got this.
I don't know him.
Bring the rush home on single disc or two disc platinum series December 23rd, rated PG-13.
This holiday, give him something he'll really love. The Philips Norelco Architect. Simplicity is giving him a gift he'll use every day.
Jolly Wilson's War has been nominated for 5 Golden Globe Awards, including Best Picture.
Without Charlie, history would be sadly different.
Sometimes you have to be unconventional to accomplish the unbelievable. Jolly Wilson's War, rated R.
During the Big Seafood Festival, come in for our biggest seafood of the year, rock lobster tail, king crab legs, and try the biggest shrimp we've ever served, colossal shrimp, at Red Lobster. Come see what's fresh today.
Joe, Giorgio Armani at Macy's.
Georgetown battles Memphis Saturday at noon on ESPN.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by K Jewelers. Every kiss begins with K. And in part by Philips Norelco. Philips, sense and simplicity.
This ESPN telecast is available in high definition on ESPN HD, presented by Olivia. Back inside the Garden, an early one, early start here between Duke and Pittsburgh. Both teams missing some shots, turning it over. Duke leading by 2 early. Dan Shulman, Jay Bilas with you. And we want to send our best wishes to our friend and my partner, Dick Vitale, who, as I think everybody knows by now, is recovering at home after throat surgery. Everything is fine. He's going to make a full recovery, be back in February. The amazing thing, doctors have told him, Jay, he can't talk, not a word, for 3 weeks.
What's the over-under on how many weeks it takes for the first word? It probably has occurred already. But
I think so.
We need you back, Dick. Hurry back. We'll keep the seat warm, but it's your seat.
Looking forward to having Dick back in February. For more, let's go to Doris Burke, who's with us tonight. Doris.
Oh, guys, Dick has been a star in college basketball for 3 decades, but I'm far prouder of my association with Dick Vitale, the man, than my colleague. We wish him the best.
I don't know if he's got a bell or a horn. I understand on his first day, he's got to write everything that he wants to say, and he writes like he talks. Just, he's really going after it. He wore out the ink in 2 pens in the first 3 hours after the surgery.
Well, I bet on that last play he was writing down, look at the slip, Kyle Singler slips the screen, intelligent.
And Singler's got 6 already. Duke leading by 4, make it 2 as Sam Young has his second field goal of the night. Good to see Sam Young healthy after so many knee problems. Just tendonitis in both knees. A Duke turnover. Ramon pushing it to Fields. And we got ourselves a tie game.
Boy, Fields, the great body control and using the left hand, and give Ronald Ramon great credit for passing ahead to get that easy hoop.
And now Greg Paulus is going to have to come out. I don't know if he's bleeding, perhaps, as they stop play.
Off the turnover, Ronald Ramon passing the ball ahead. And Levance Fields doing a good job of looking over that right shoulder and drawing the contact. He could have easily gone to the free throw line on that, but absorbed the bump and still finished the play. That is one tough hombre at the point for Pittsburgh.
Paul is cut, so he goes out. Nolan Smith checks in. All 3 freshmen in the game right now for Duke. Great position inside by Singler. He lost it on the way up.
Well, it was knocked away from him by the great hands of Levance Fields.
You know, Dan, we talked at the top of the broadcast about this being a heavyweight fight, and already we need a cut man.
Barely 6 minutes in. Think about Levance Fields. He took over from Carl Krauser, who took over from Brandon Knight, who's on the staff right now with Pittsburgh. That's a pretty good run of 7 or 8 years of the point guard position.
No question. To have that kind of stability, that makes a coach's job that much easier. And that's where Pittsburgh has an advantage in this game. This is a very good rebounding team that picks off about 15 offensive boards per game.
Tyrell Biggs comes up with the offensive rebound and draws the foul. Brian Zubek, a 7-1 sophomore, checks into the game, and now for Duke, one of a number of Blue Devils who had some offseason surgery. And he has not quite gotten to where they need him to get, Jay. They want some minutes. He's really their only true size guy.
He's a guy who needs to get stick backs, block shots, and grab rebounds, but Pittsburgh needs to involve him in some screening, move him around. Duke going with a little 2-3 zone.
Young tries a three, a shot he has taken and hit with much more regularity this season, but not this time. King at the other end. He's had 6 threes in one game, had 5 in another, but missed off to the right that time. Some of the crowd wanted to travel. The floater not there for Keith Benjamin, one of the stalwarts off the Pitt bench. The pace quickening, although nobody's knocking down shots until DeMarcus Nelson buries one.
Nelson is a driver slasher, but when he gets his feet set, he can knock shots down. You've got to make him put the ball on the floor, but make him put it on the deck in order to pull up, not to get to the rim.
44% from beyond the arc so far this year. The senior DeMarcus Nelson, another guy who's battled a lot of injuries the last couple of years. Deep three not there for Fields, and here comes Shire.
That was a bailout shot. Didn't need that one.
Shire got it taken away. No call as he got knocked down. Fields lays it into the other end.
Well, he got hit there, but that's what Mike Krzyzewski was talking about, this being a man's game. You're not going to get every call, so you better be strong with the ball.
They may not be, they being Pitt, may not be as physical as they've been in recent years, but they're still an awfully tough team. Oh, Shire open for three, and he'll shoot three.
A little bit overly aggressive on the part of Benjamin to go out and foul a three-point shooter. But this team bumps every cut. They stand you up on your cuts, and you can see a terrific job by Young to knock that ball away. Did he get some arm? Probably, but didn't get it called, and it's 2 points for Pittsburgh.
So here's John Shire, the sophomore out of Northbrook, Illinois, a 90% free throw shooter. And Paul, as you can see, the cut under his right eye that knocked him out of the game as they had to close it up. He'll no doubt come back in, but he's got himself a pretty good gash there.
Well, he's taken plenty of hits in his career, not only in basketball, but he was an outstanding football player in high school, a quarterback that set records in the state of New York. But there's no helmet out there tonight.
David McClure into the game for the first time for Duke. Shire, by the way, cannot remember the last time that he was not a regular starter in basketball. Always has been. He accepted it. He still gets his minutes, but it's been an adjustment for him. He sizes up the game, and he could come in, Jay, for any of the 5 starters when he checks in, usually about 4 minutes into the game.
Well, he's a gamer. Makes great reads offensively. His job is to make open shots, and you can see Duke ratcheting up their pressure.
How about Biggs trying a three? Zubek comes down with a rebound.
I think Biggs has got to try to drive Brian Zubek. Make him come out. You just don't want to take a jump shot.
Another Duke turnover, and then a foul on Nolan Smith trying to get it back. So we'll step aside. A good, intense, physical start to this game with a Duke leading Pitt by 3. New York always beautiful around the holiday season. We got a good one here at the Garden.
Gear when it's cold. Available at Dick's Sporting Goods, your Under Armour headquarters.
Cold gear when it's cold. Available at Dick's Sporting Goods, your Under Armour headquarters.
Can I help you?
Oh, I'm just going down my holiday gift list one last time, see if there's anybody I've missed.
And is there?
Yes.
Who?
Everybody.
Last-minute holiday shopping? Come to Lowe's and get 20% off all power tool combo kits, 20% off all in-stock small kitchen appliances, 10% off all shop vacs, 10% off all Whirlpool and Maytag appliances, plus free in-stock delivery in time for Christmas. And for the gift that's right for everybody, pick up a Lowe's gift card.
Get everybody?
Got everybody.
Lowe's. Let's build something together.
They want a sequel now. How are we supposed to get in touch with these people?
Watch and learn.
Talk to me.
Sequel's greenlit.
How greenlit?
How green is money?
That's great.
Yes.
Yes.
Welcome to a network where dream teams happen. At the push of a button. Cisco. Welcome to the human network.
What a game it should be on Saturday afternoon in Memphis. Number two, Memphis. Number four, Georgetown. Each of them undefeated. Part of a special Saturday to remember. Planned on spending the day indoors watching as many as five great basketball games on our family of networks. Jay and Doris and I will be in Memphis. Let's talk about the Hoyas and the Tigers a little bit.
Yeah, we always talk about the freshmen. Derrick Rose had 26 points against Cincinnati, and Georgetown has Austin Freeman and Chris Wright, but they also have seniors. Roy Hibbert and Jonathan Wallace, two of the best seniors in America. Chris Douglas Roberts with Memphis, an outstanding senior as well. And for Tennessee, Chris Lofton goes against Drew Lavender, two great seniors in that matchup. You know, great freshmen all around the country, but we can't forget about the great seniors as well. And Saturday is going to be a great day for college basketball.
And Texas in the first year AD after Durant, they're having themselves a pretty special season so far.
Absolutely. You know, Duke really trying to get some pressure and make it difficult for Pittsburgh to run their sets. Look how much further out on the floor that Pittsburgh is having to start their offense.
Bilas remains on the bench after sustaining that cut a few moments ago. Dewan Blair has returned for Pitt. Hits Gilbert Brown for the open baseline jumper. And one thing that the Pittsburgh staff feel that Blair is going to be exceptional at is passing out of the post.
Well, he did a great job there. He showed great poise and really did a nice job of looking cross court to the open man. And Dan, that's where Gerald Henderson has really improved his game this year. A much better shooter, in much better condition. He's one of the most improved players, not only in the ACC, but I think in the country.
And a guy with some unbelievable upside, great athleticism, knocking down the jumper, his second field goal of the night. Duke is 6-for-8 from the floor, but they've turned it over 8 times already. Brown, a very athletic 6'6 wingman, a medical redshirt last year for the Panthers, misses the shot, and now a call goes against Pitt. There's the damage sustained by Bilas. Here's how it happened.
Bilas coming over to double team, and it was actually Singler that caught him with that left elbow. So Kyle Singler making an impact on the game with his own team.
Zubek goes out. Keep in mind, Gerald Henderson is playing with two fouls right now for the Blue Devils. Nolan Smith misses the jumper, and what a rebound by Blair. Ripped it down with one and then smacked his hands together to make sure he didn't lose it.
Boy, we're seeing a lot of big guys having to switch out on guards, and you can see the great feat of Dewan Blair switching off on that ball screen and staying in front of the handle.
Pitt down three midway through the first half here at Madison Square Garden in New York City. Little hook from the baseline by Blair misses, and the rebound of the Blue Devils.
Well, he missed that, but turned away nicely from the double team that was coming from the middle.
Henderson and Brown with a blocked shot.
Well, what an athlete.
Those are probably the two best athletes in this game as Blair is fouled hard. And will go right back to the free throw line.
Well, how about that pass by Tyrell Biggs? Usually you give the ball to a big guy that far away from the basket on the break, and you're asking for a turnover. He caught it, did not shuffle his feet, and delivered the ball very nicely after the great block by Brown, starting the break himself. And what great hands and presence by Biggs.
Blair misses the free throw. Here comes Bilas back into the game for Duke. Levance Fields returns for Pitt.
Blair is a good free throw shooter, and he is going to get there a lot on the season. He needs to knock these down.
Misses them both. McClure had it and is fouled by Biggs.
Well, the
the depth of these teams is going to be tested given the early foul situation for both teams.
When DeJuan Blair gets the ball into the post, you can see Brian Zubek trying to take away the baseline side, and a terrific job. There was a double team that was coming from the middle, and a terrific job to sort of open up and look cross court to the open man.
Blair having to chase Singler way out on the perimeter. Singler goes by him. Three from the corner is long. Weak side, a rebound to Levance Fields. Head up as he pushes it up the court. And Cook stepped out of bounds.
A lot of credit there to Greg Paulus for coming over and stopping that penetration on the baseline. Transition defense in this game is very important for both teams, but especially for Pittsburgh, because they've got to get back. Anybody that gets a rebound for Duke can push it up on their own.
Singler misses the three. Shire has it rejected by Blair. Just got a piece of it.
Well, Singler can knock that shot down. I think he's a better mid-range player than he is a long-range shooter, but Shire there to try to go back up, and Blair, who blocks just under two shots per game, sending that out.
Don't you love a guy who plays with the energy and the personality that DeJuan Blair has?
Well, you can see that he loves it, and I think that smile infectious for his teammates as well. He has fun, and you're supposed to have fun playing this game.
Henderson misses the three, and another rebound for DeJuan Blair.
Blair really goes up with both hands every time to get rebounds.
Fields going all the way, but a wave it off. An offensive foul on Levance Fields.
Well, Lance Thomas doing a nice job, but a difficult call because Levance Fields looked like he had a little bit of an angle. But give Lance Thomas credit for putting his body on the line in transition.
Not a popular call with the Pitt fans. Let's go to Doris Burke.
Guys, uncharacteristically, Pitt turning the basketball over, but one of the staff's keys was, where do those turnovers come? If they come off dead balls and not in the open floor, Duke can't capitalize and put points on the board, and thus far, those turnovers have not translated for Duke.
Well, that's a great point, Doris. Anytime you have live ball turnovers where it puts your transition defense into a scramble mode, that's a problem. You're going to give up high percentage shots, but if you can make Duke, even after a turnover, play against your half-court defense, you're going to be that much better off.
6 points off turnovers thus far for the Blue Devils. Paul is inside to Thomas, and Tyrell Biggs forced to foul. Well, tonight, Capital One Bowl Week kicks off here on ESPN. Over 20 bowl games in 12 days on the ESPN family of networks opens with Utah against Navy. The San Diego County Credit Union appoints Setta Bowl at 9 o'clock tonight. And for Navy, coach Ken Niamatalolo. Help me, help me.
That's why you like Paul Johnson in that position,
right?
Don't you?
Coach, good luck tonight with the Navy. Coach Ken Niamatalolo makes his debut, replacing Paul Johnson, who just took the job at Georgia Tech.
Get that guy a nickname. Coach N.
Well, it starts with a K. Is Coach K taken?
Coach K, well, it is. It's a trademark. Yeah. Oh, every time you say it, you got to give Coach K a nickel.
Thomas just coming back from a sprained ankle. And Thomas and Singler, both about 6'8", 220. They're the biggest guys that Duke has on the floor most of the time. Zubek will get some minutes off the bench, but not all that many.
And Thomas coming off an ankle injury, it's going to be interesting to see how effective he is moving those feet, especially when he switches off to a guard.
Another turnover as Young travels.
Well, Young, when he gets the ball on the perimeter, he played the three last year, had some knee problems, wasn't as explosive as he's been, but he played behind Levon Kendall at the four. He is a very difficult matchup problem at the four, and that's one of the reasons he's much more explosive, healthier this year, but he's also playing a position that he can really exploit at the four spot.
Averaging almost 18 points per game. Good show there by Blair.
It's actually a switch, and they need to get the ball inside to Thomas. That's even better.
And he scores over Ramon. Good call, Jay.
Anytime you have a little on big switch, you've got to be strong with the ball and deliver it to the mismatch down low. Duke did a great job of that and got an easy basket as a result.
So the Blue Devils have upped their lead to 6. Well, there is a very significant person in both cities for both programs. We'll tell you about Dick Rowe when we come back.
Tuesday.
You're done.
Double Deep Pizza with double the toppings.
Double.
Pizza Hut's new Double Deep Pizza. Double it up with double the toppings and 50% more cheese. Get one now for just $12.99. Double means more with America's favorite pizza, Pizza Hut. Order online.
Bowl Week kicks off tonight as Utah battles Navy at 9 Eastern on ESPN.
Hi, I'm Keith Hernandez here at Coin Galleries of Oyster Bay. Old coins can be valuable, so whether you're buying or selling, deal with the best. The professionals at Coin Galleries of Oyster Bay. Bring in your coins, paper money, sports memorabilia, gold, and diamond jewelry. You'll always get a free appraisal and a fair price. Come visit my teammates at Coin Galleries of Oyster Bay.
Coin Galleries of Oyster Bay, Long Island's largest rare coin and memorabilia store. Now with two locations, Oyster Bay and Limerick. Call 1-800-200-0129.
The 2007 Jets are on the field with their TV home, SNY. SNY puts you in the front row for Eric Mangini's live press conferences on Jets Open Mic, presented by Motorola. First and Goal with Mike Tannenbaum is a weekly sit-down in the SNY studios with the Jets GM. Jets Extra Point, presented by New Jersey Lottery, is your recap of the game before and a look at what's ahead. And Jets Post Game Live immediately follows every Jets game this season with full coverage of the game and reaction from the team. The TV home of the New York Jets is SNY.
It's your New York sports here.
Our first bowl game of the college football season starts here after this game. Football news, Bill Parcells has signed, he's sealed, and delivered to the Dolphins. Executive Vice President of Football Operations, Wayne Huizenga, says his acumen will help put the Dolphins back among the elite. Pac-Man Jones, still suspended, will serve the final two games of the season-long suspension. The NFL said no to an appeal by the Players Union on Thursday. ESPN News is always on.
All right, Carl, we're conflicted loyalties for these two. Is it Duke or is it Pitt? And maybe the same thing applies to one of the great athletes that isn't remembered enough for the athleticism and the accomplishments that he had. Dick Groat from Pittsburgh, played at Duke, played baseball and played basketball at Duke, a two-time All-American, the National Player of the Year as a Blue Devil in 1952. Get this, led the nation in scoring and assists in the same year. And then, oh yeah, went on to play Major League Baseball for 13 years, won a batting title, a five-time All-Star, and was the MVP of the National League when the Pittsburgh Pirates won the World Series in 1960, beating the New York Yankees. Dick Groat says, I like baseball, but I like basketball more. I was better at basketball. And I think he was just coming out as you were coming in, right? He gave you your campus tour?
Just about, yeah. Actually. I've known him for over 20 years. Don't know a better guy.
Yes.
Dick Groat is one of the all-time greats, not only in baseball, but also in basketball. Just a great human being.
That would be his fourth on the evening.
And Dick Groat, as you saw, his 29th year as the color commentator on Pittsburgh radio broadcast. Paulus for three. And Jamie Dixon needs a timeout. It's an 8-0 run for the Blue Devils. Greg Paulus shooting the ball extremely well for the second year in a row.
Greg Paulus, one of the best shooters on this Duke roster. When he gets his feet set, he can drill it.
I'm Deneen Verricchio, and this is my story. Around this time, the holiday, I help to hand out food. The families feel very good when they open up their doors. I have arthritis in my fingers, in my elbows, in my knees. It just took my life away. I stopped doing a lot of things, especially volunteering. I take leave in the morning. It does work. I'm off and running. If I didn't have a leave, I wouldn't be able to accomplish the things that I do. It feeds your soul to do something good for others.
Back here in New York, you're watching Duke in Pittsburgh. It's Holiday Hoops on ESPN, presented by K Jewelers. Dan Shulman, Jay Bilas, Doris Burke, glad you're along with us here tonight. And Duke, on an 8-0 run, has extended its lead to 9. Turnovers, a big problem early in this game. And both teams committing a fairly high number of fouls as well. Pittsburgh right now, Jay, really having trouble establishing anything offensively.
Well, they're letting the pressure push them out a little further on the floor, and I think they've settled for some jump shots, trying to make early reads and take advantage of some mismatches, but they haven't been able to do it.
with great efficiency. And this is a very efficient basketball team. Duke is offensively the most efficient team in the country. Pittsburgh's third.
Quick double team on Blair, and he is called for the foul, trying to bull his way out of it. Number two on DeJuan Blair.
Well, Duke did a nice job of denying the pass out on ball side. You can see the double team coming over from Lance Thomas, and instead of getting the ball out, he tries to split that double and puts Thomas on his back and picks up a foul.
Blair will stay with the two. Pittsburgh scoreless for the last 4 minutes and 15 seconds.
Blair doing a better job on that last screen of showing than recovering to his man.
Thomas to Shire to Nelson, who misses the three, and Fields a good tap to keep that ball. He tapped it over to Blair.
Just a smart play by Levance Fields, who is just a really good guard.
And Fields, a guy who lost 15 pounds in the summer with his smaller lineup. He knew they'd be playing faster, and he wanted to lose some weight. But Pitt maybe playing a little bit too fast right now as they turn it over again.
It looks like DeJuan Blair getting a little bit frustrated, taking on two defenders there, and just wasn't strong enough with the ball, got a strip. One reason is he brought it down.
Singler with a high arcing soft touch on the jump shot.
And Singler got the mismatch with Levance Fields guarding him down on the low block, and immediately went to that turnaround jumper and took his time because he had the size and the length advantage to shoot over the top.
He's got eight. Before Singler played a single minute of meaningful basketball for the Blue Devils, Mike Krzyzewski had already said he's going to be a very special player. A carry, and it's the 12th turnover on Pitt.
Well, Pittsburgh has been unable to run anything, but Kyle Singler getting the ball against the mismatch and taking his time. He knew that a double team wasn't coming, kept his head up and looked at all the options, and was very poised and very patient inside.
A 30-second timeout taken by Jamie Dixon. Well, no surprise that Kyle Singler is a pretty athletic guy. It's in the blood, Jay.
Well, when they had their pickup games out in the driveway, it looks like there was a long time to wait if you lost.
I'd like to see the Singlers play the Paulises, just have like a superstars competition between the two families.
And it looks like the family's been able to put away a few bucks. They haven't paid for college.
And some solid numbers for Kyle Singler already tonight.
Well, Kyle Singler is a complete basketball player. You can see him coming out to set this little run-out ball screen. The immediate slip, just a great read and a terrific delivery. Again, coming down in transition instead of going to the low block. Another great read. The slip, the help, too slow coming over. Pittsburgh's got to do a better job of seeing the ball and being in better position on the help side to be able to get over there and either steal that or take a charge.
People familiar with the Pittsburgh program will know this. This is a building the Panthers consider to be their second home. This is their house. They have won a Big East championship here. They've played great here. They've got five players on this team from the New York City area. They do not like coming into this building and struggling as much as they have tonight.
They need to get the Singler. He was wide open. Fields on him again.
It'll stay with Duke. 19 on the shot clock.
And Duke gets that mismatch after some switches. They need to get that ball to Singler right away. And they took advantage of a sleeping Pitt D.
And Singler missed one from in tight on the inbounds play.
Pittsburgh needs to get something easy. Everything they've been looking at, every shot, has been difficult and challenged.
Young on the baseline, and Pittsburgh now scoreless for almost the last 6 minutes.
That's a shot that Sam Young needs to hit, but again, it was another challenge shot.
Paulus was thinking pass. Singler was expecting the shot. Fields off balance, knocks it down.
Boy, a tough one, but maybe something in transition will get this offense going a little bit and get a better feeling for these Pitt players, because against the half-court defense of Duke, they've really not been able to get much good. A little flex cut by Henderson.
And Henderson again, good touch on that medium, that mid-range jump shot. Second one he's hit tonight.
He really shows a lot of poise. Reminds you of a 6'4 Grant Hill.
Boy, Pittsburgh just not playing well at all right now. Another turnover there, 13. Another basket for Henderson. Jamie Dixon's already taken two timeouts here in the first half.
Well, they're frustrated right now. They're chirping at each other. Their body language not very good. They need to get a leader that's going to take control and take charge. Get a huddle during the next timeout and really come out a lot stronger, because right now they've been knocked back on their heels and need to respond.
Well, Fields is that guy. Here's Young. And he traveled.
A nice back cut, but you still have to be able to finish the play. And right now Pittsburgh completely out of sorts on the offensive end. The pressure is bothering the Panthers. You see a little bit lazy on the pass, and Gerald Henderson. Just so smooth and so athletic and so strong at 6'4". He's really doing a much better job of getting the ball to the rim and playing with much more poise.
Nelson the kick. King in the corner for three.
That is a Taylor King layup.
Anytime that Taylor King is on the floor, he feels like he's open. And he is conscience-free with shot selection.
A 17-2 run for the Duke Blue Devils. They lead 31-15 over Pittsburgh.
And Duke puts the ball on the floor. It collapses the defense, and that is a lot of ground for Tyrell Biggs to cover. And Taylor King, who was born a natural righty, but his father's a left-hander, encouraged King to become a left-hander. And he has got some crazy range. When he steps across half court, he thinks he's open, and he's unafraid to shoot it.
And usually, Dan, it's guys who are volume shooters that have no conscience. But even with just a few shots a game, Taylor King is unafraid to pull the trigger.
And Taylor King, a guy who committed to UCLA prior to high school, then opened up his recruiting again in his sophomore season, eventually decided to go to Duke, averaging 16 points per game in his last five, and fourth all-time in California high school history. DeMarcus Nelson is number one.
Well, I'm from California. I just didn't have the benefit of the three-point shot.
Well, we didn't have room to put the top six on there. Otherwise, I think we would have snuck you in. Here's Singler. Nice strip by Blair, the big guy with good hands.
Amazing hands. You can see why he leads this team in steals, over two per game.
Fields gets a clean look and knocks down a three. Maybe that will turn the tide for the Panthers.
And part of that was because of the poise and the presence of Gilbert Brown. He didn't panic with the ball in the wing. Nice little shot fake. Let the defense run by. Another slip by Singler.
This is the jumper. Another rebound for Blair. Almost had it taken away from behind. He's got 8 rebounds, the big fella, already. Brown. Shire has the loose ball.
It's been difficult for Pittsburgh to get offensive rebounds because their shots haven't come in their normal rhythm. Their offensive rebounders don't really know when to go to the glass. They're bothered by the pressure. They're trying to become receivers, and they haven't been rebounders.
Singler, the offensive rebound of the miss by Shire. King is open again. And rebound number 9 for DeJuan Blair, and he is fouled.
But how about that rebound by Blair? Not going over the back, using his length and his strength.
ESPN, your NBA destination. Kevin Garnett, Paul Pierce, and Ray Allen have lifted the Celtics to the top of the league and tied the best start in franchise history. Friday, they look to continue their historic run as they host the Bulls. Then, the Clippers battle MVP Dirk Nowitzki and the Mavericks. NBA Friday night doubleheader. Bulls Celtics and Clippers Mavericks. Coverage begins at 7 Eastern on ESPN.
It's gut check time. I tell you what, whoever stops him gets a Bud Light on me.
Let's go, fellas. What?
Endless refreshment from start to finish. Bud Light keeps it coming.
What? It was a clean hit?
All right, freight. Well, you already love the reliability of the big brown truck, but let's say you're shipping something really big or pallets of lots of little things. Now, wouldn't it be great if you could send any size shipment with the reliability and tracking you're used to with UPS? Hey, look, now you can. It's not just freight, it's UPS freight. Throw some mud flaps on here.
You ready for this?
Yeah.
Hello.
Hi, honey.
Hey, where are you guys?
I
got stuck at work. I can't pick him up from practice.
You promised.
Yeah, I know.
I'm sorry.
That's fine.
I'll go get him.
Okay.
I love...
She hung up on me.
Just a little something.
Find some of the best values of the year at the Lexus December to Remember sales event, now through January 2nd, at your Lexus dealer.
Halftime report comes up. We'll talk about Bill Parcells, who has signed a deal 4 years to be the Dolphins executive vice president of football operations, trying to put the Dolphins back on the map. Meantime, Memphis gets set for a huge game. The Tigers are unbeaten. Will they stay that way? Steve Lavin joins us to talk about their upcoming game. Big boys in action this weekend. That's ahead. And the Sutton brothers, All in the Family, Sean and Scott do battle. That game can be seen on ESPN2. We'll see you at the half.
All right, Carl, thank you. Well, Brandon Knight, one tough hombre when he played point guard for Pitt, and his brother, pretty accomplished point guard, Brevin, now playing in the NBA. And the Paulus family has, what, six brothers who all played some kind of a sport collegiately?
Yeah, one of them's playing quarterback in North Carolina now, backup quarterback that redshirted this year, so that's another athletic family.
Can you imagine? I mean, again, you talked about, did you have any brothers growing up?
Yeah, I still have one.
Decided to keep him around,
heck
huh?
of a player, heck of a golfer, named Dave.
And there's... There's the proud papa, Dave Paulus, six boys. And Paulus, of course, a terrific high school football and basketball player, elected to play point guard at Duke over quarterback at Notre Dame. And I know you've said you played at Duke, so you know this better than anybody. Playing at Duke, you're under the microscope. Playing point guard at Duke, you might be under the microscope more than any other college basketball player in the land. DeMarcus Nelson with an easy lay-in.
Well, a great backdoor cut and a terrific delivery by Taylor King. Just dribbling that way. And the defense jumping out in the passing lane and being exploited by the backdoor cut.
You know, Jay, we talk about Duke being so good defensively. What is it specifically that makes them so tough? Whoa, as Brown misses the follow. What is it that makes Duke so tough and has taken Pittsburgh right out of their offense?
Well, they put really good pressure on the ball. They take away vision and they deny passes. That pushes you a little bit further out on the floor. They deny entry passes, try to take away ball reversal. So in order to really be effective against that kind of pressure, you've got to be able to operate in breakdown situations. If your offense, if you can't make an entry pass, you've got to be able to dribble enter the ball. Put it in a position where you can get something done, and you've got to operate when your plays break down. So far, Pittsburgh hasn't been able to do that.
And do you feel that the players who come to Duke, Zubac, can't corral it, can't control it, turns it over. Here comes Fields. Ramon, a very good shooter, misses the three. And now Duke looking to run. Pittsburgh caught a little bit behind the play. Mike Krzyzewski will take a timeout. A 15-point lead for the Blue Devils with a minute 24 to go here in the first half. Well, Holiday Hoops presented by K Jewelers continues on ESPN and ESPN2 Saturday with a couple of great games. Two more unbeaten teams, Georgetown against Memphis at noon Eastern here on ESPN. Later on in the day at 6:30 Eastern time on ESPN2 at the Palace in Auburn Hills. It'll be Michigan State playing Texas. As mentioned, Georgetown and Memphis among the undefeateds. So is Texas. So this is not going to be an easy game for Michigan State. How do you size up that matchup?
Well, Michigan State, I think, is a terrific team because they are strong defensively. Their transition defense is very good, and they've got Drew Neitzel, who's an outstanding senior. I think with Texas, you've got a team that has really surprised a lot of people. They're a year older, even though they're without Kevin Durant. DJ Augustine has established himself as, if not the best point guard in America, one of the top two, along with UCLA's Darren Collison, in my judgment. And he has been absolutely magnificent.
And just like Sam Young has stepped up in the absence of Aaron Gray and Levon Kendall, guys like Damian James, Connor Ashley really getting it done for Texas.
Well, both Damian James and Connor Ashley, I think, are two of the most improved players, not only in the Big 12 Conference, but I think overall in the country. I mean, Ashley has been terrific all season long.
Other games on Saturday, the Bragging Rights game, always fun between Illinois and Missouri. They'll play in St. Louis. Tennessee's going to take on a Xavier team that earlier this season beat Indiana by 15.
Well, you can see Duke really keeping the floor spread, and when DeMarcus Nelson puts the ball on the floor, he tries to get that front shoulder out in front of you as a defender and then turn it into you. And when he does that, he creates contact. A lot of times that contact is called for a foul and he steps to the free throw line. But this is the one place where he has some issues. Not a great free throw shooter.
59% on the season as he gets a little help on the first. The lone scholarship senior on the team, the only captain. Last year they went with tri-captains, but this year they decided he's the only senior. Let's make him the man.
Well, they've been using the captaincy as a little bit of a ceremonial position, and they decided to take it back to a leadership position. And Nelson has been their best leader.
One of two, and a Duke foul. Is it Thomas?
It looked like they had Lance Thomas reaching in. This is an important last minute of this first half. Pittsburgh, if they can
get these free throws to go, get a stop, get a couple of scores, get a better feeling going into halftime, because this has been a brutal offensive half for Pittsburgh.
And both of these coaches looked at this game as if it were a simulated big-time NCAA tournament game, a Sweet 16, an Elite Eight, that kind of a thing, a neutral court with fans split between the two teams. And it's something, as you know, again, having played at Duke and watching them, among others, over the years, Mike Krzyzewski he'll go to wherever the ACC tournament is held every year. He'll play good mid-major teams because that could be the kind of team they might play in the first round of the tournament. He'll play different styles, different buildings, try to get as much experience and variety for his team over the year as he can.
Well, I think Jamie Dixon is doing the same thing. They're both trying to get their team as much quality experience as they can, because they'll be that much better for it as the season comes to a close.
And Paulus going a little bit too quickly. He turns it over. Well, let's talk about the Pittsburgh schedule. November wasn't that difficult, but they have stepped it up this month. They've stepped it up this year over recent years. They got a one-point win, a nail-biter, but Washington beat Oklahoma State by 17. The Blue Devils tonight, and then at Dayton on the 29th, and Dayton's got a good team.
Dayton's got a really good team. Brian Roberts, one of the best senior guards in America. Brian Gregory's got a really solid group. Team that won at Louisville. Great pass.
Blair inside.
You can see Blair can really move his feet. Now Pittsburgh needs to get a stop. If they can get a stop, they're only 12 points down. And they'll have a little bit of a better feeling going into the half.
Under 10 seconds. Shot clock turned off. Thomas looking to hand off for Paulus, who got knocked down. Now 3 seconds. Shire. And Pittsburgh gets the stop. They score the last 4 points of the half, and they actually get back within 12. It was worse early. Not a good half for Pittsburgh as Duke closes on a 20-9 run, but the Panthers do score the last 4 points of the half.
And that 20-9 run was a defensive run rather than an offensive one. Duke shut them down. It wasn't that they ran away offensively.
Now let's join Carl Ravitch in the studio for the K Jewelers halftime reports.
Hi, Dan, the King of the Sport. Love to watch Taylor King get in there and fire the ball up, but he didn't spend much time on the floor. Instead, watching a very impressive Duke performance in the first half. Steve Lavin is here. I'm Carl Ravitch. When you think about what they might talk about in that Pittsburgh locker room, where does it start?
Well, if you're Pittsburgh, number one, you want to start by playing better defense, taking care of the basketball. They've had too many empty possessions. And when you have an empty possession, that means you don't have a chance at a three-point attempt, a two-point attempt. You don't have a chance to get fouled. All kinds of problems off that. Plus, off your turnovers, it gets Duke in transition for easy baskets. So a number of problems for Pittsburgh right now. But give the Blue Devils credit. Stingy defense. They collapsed well in the first half here on DeJuan Blair, the standout Pittsburgh freshman. They were alert, aggressive, heads up, like a Venus flytrap here. Look at the quick help. The frustration here as Blair just goes through, and the offensive foul picked up there. And again, another look defensively as Krzyzewski kept his team very fresh. I thought they substituted very liberally. And Duke, both ends of the floor, very sharp, Carl.
All right, so they get a good run at the end of the half, but this doesn't strike you as a team like Duke that can score in bunches. Can Pittsburgh come back?
Well, the good news, if you're a Pittsburgh fan or you're Jamie Dixon, is you do start four upperclassmen who have a lot of experience. DeJuan Blair, the postman, is going to learn from this first half. He's only a freshman, but he's surrounded by Levance Fields, by Mike Cook, by Sam Young, by Ronald Ramon. And those players have played in a lot of games. There's no quick hitter here. You got to chip away. You know, one possession at a time, try and execute, get a stop, execute again offensively, and just chip away at the lead.
Early couple of minutes of the second half might tell the story. Meantime, this Pittsburgh team gets Georgetown January 14th on ESPN. Next up for Georgetown, an unbeaten Memphis Tiger team this weekend. We'll look at Calipari's club when we come back.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by T. Rowe Price, providing investment management excellence for over 70 years. Invest with confidence. And the Lexus December to Remember sales event, now through January 2nd.
Disciplined investing. At T. Rowe Price, it's not just about the short term. It's about a steady, long-term approach. For each 3, 5, and 10-year period, over 70% of our mutual funds beat their Lipper average. Low-cost mutual funds from T. Rowe Price. Invest with confidence. Request a complete prospectus or profile with investment objectives, risks, fees, expenses, and other information to read and consider carefully before investing.
Baby, it's cold outside.
I've got to go away.
Baby, it's cold out there.
This evening has been
hoping that you
so
drop
very
in.
Nice.
I'll take your hands, the cold is
I ought
there.
To say no, no, no,
I'm
sir. At least I'm gonna stay.
Come in from the cold at the Lexus December to Remember sales event. Now through January 2nd.
Whether you've been naughty or nice,
get some, baby!
You deserve the new American Pie Beta House.
Woo.
This holiday, get the gift you really want.
That's what being a stifler's all about.
Yay.
American Pie presents Beta House, unrated. Get it on DVD Sunday.
So, what you going for?
I want it all.
Then come try our Super Sampler Combo. Crispy battered fish, succulent chicken, and three butterfly shrimp. All for just $3.99. Only at Long John Silver's.
Pirates.
Are you prepared for what's next?
Sign me up.
I promise you will not be disappointed. Count on that.
Pirates. Fios TV On Demand brings you thousands of the hottest shows and movies anytime you want.
Toasted double melts are here. Now, two for $3.33. Checkers Toasted Double Melts. Two juicy patties. Your choice of American or new Pepper Jack. Just two for $3.33. Only at Checkers. Little place, big taste. Checkers. Oh, and don't you forget Checkers' famous season fries. Oh, yeah.
This halftime report is presented by K Jewelers. Every kiss begins with K.
Well, family act is Oral Roberts head coach is Scott Sutton. His brother, of course, is Sean Sutton. He coaches OK State. You don't know college basketball, you'd think this is an OK State win, but you don't know Robert Jarvis, who, like Taylor King from Duke, wherever he is on that side of the half-court line, it's going up.
Torching the Nets.
And it's going in. Robert Jarvis in a 25-15 game to the rack.
A little change of pace, a little stutter step.
Beep beeper. He's done that play. 27-15. Are you kidding me? Oral Roberts is up 17 on Oklahoma State.
Well, at some point, an athletic director or school president has to recognize that Scott Sutton can coach the game. He's built the power at Oral Roberts. Last year, knocked off the Jayhawks in Allen Fieldhouse. Looks like another upset here against his brother.
Noon Eastern, 9 o'clock out west for those that are arising in California to watch what should be an outstanding game Saturday, folks. And for the first time in Memphis's history, they get to host a game in which they and the other team are ranked in the top five. This is really an exciting early season game, if you will, for these two teams. And I think last night we got a chance to watch Memphis struggle a little bit, but you get the sense watching this Derrick Rose guy, when it comes right down to it, game on the line, I got it, guys. You kind of watch this.
Well, he's one of the outstanding freshmen at 6'4". He wants the ball in his hands in critical situations. And what he gives John Calipari is the basketball player necessary in late clock, late game situations to make plays. A
one-on-one.
Crunch time performer. He can go to work off the bounce, create for himself and his teammates, and stroke him the ball. Once he starts knocking down shots consistently from the perimeter, that's going to stretch defenses and allow him to then use the bounce and his speed and quickness to get to the rim and create for himself and teammates.
He had 5 threes last night in that victory. One of the problems Memphis has had, 3-point shooting. You think about Georgetown, good guard play. They got Hibbert inside, who's a monster. I mean, how do you see the game beyond Rose?
Well, I think the key to this game is tempo. You know, Georgetown prefers to play at varying speeds. They can play up tempo in transition. They have some excellent athletes, but they ultimately want to pound away, dismantle opponents through their spread court, Princeton international style offense. And that keeps Roy Hibbert at 7'2" involved in the game. But don't kid yourself, Georgetown does have some good athletes, a good front line with DeJuan Summers at 6'8" with Patrick Ewing Jr. But I think the point guard play in this matchup going to be critical, Carl. Jonathan Wallace for Georgetown started 110 games, a senior. Every game of his career, he started, directs the attack. And on the flip side, Derrick Rose, we spoke about, he ignites the Memphis offense.
It's going to be fun. Excited about it. Noon Eastern again on ESPN. I know you wanted to talk about other conferences, but this is going to be a good conference game for both, just to see where they are. One team from the Big East and the other, of course, from Conference USA. We'll come back here. It's been the Kyle Singler-led Duke Blue Devils. Game got a little tighter at the end, but it's 34-22 with the second half coming up.
Honey, I found the perfect tree.
Really? What makes it perfect?
It comes with a present.
This Christmas, how do you thank her for choosing you? With a beautiful gift of gold from Kay Jewelers. And you can be assured that Kay will have a spectacular assortment of gold jewelry. Only gold glows.
This the one, ma'am?
Yes. This is the one.
Every kiss begins with Kay.
Show. Giorgio Armani at Macy's.
The next time you want a clean, comfortable shave, change heads.
Wow. There's a good-looking face.
Hey, guys.
Introducing the Remington Clean Exchange, the only electric shaver featuring a disposable head you never have to clean, and two nano silver foils that reduce irritation. The Remington Clean Exchange.
Honey.
Want a better shave? Change heads. Clean Exchange from Remington. First name in shaving.
You hear that?
What?
I think I hear reindeer.
Come on, everybody! Let's go! All right! A new table saw for me? Are you kidding? Way to go, Santa! Woo!
Right now, get a Ryobi 18-volt cordless tool free with the purchase of select combo kits up to a $69 value. The Home Depot. You can do it. We can help.
Oh, look, there's a ladder, too.
Balls of Fury. Bring it home for the holidays today.
Get everything you want this holiday season. There's no law that says you can't get yourself a little something. The Lexus December to Remember sales event. Now through January 2nd at your Lexus dealer.
This halftime report is presented by K Jewelers. Every kiss begins with K.
You figure most people Bill Parcells' age move down to Florida, get the early bird special, you know, lay it low, hit the beats. Not Parcells, a four-year deal to run the Miami Dolphins. Comfy in the South Beach sun.
My familiarity with Wayne Huizenga, I've known him for a number of years. I really didn't know him very well, but I did know him. And all the people that I do know that had ever worked for him had nothing but very, very good things to say about him. And we do have a couple of mutual friends as well. And those guys also had such a high regard for him that I kind of felt like I knew him. And as you said, I have a place in South Florida. I've been down there for 20 years, off and on. So it's a place I'm comfortable with.
Not ready to shut it down. They hope that Parcells can sort of be the architect to rebuild this program. At Duke, there's no rebuilding. They just kind of reload. This is a very impressive team, at least it has been so far this season, being unbeaten, and it was again in the first half.
Well, you know, Duke playing extremely well. If you're Pittsburgh and Jamie Dixon, the good news is your team played about as poorly as they can possibly play. 1 of 9 from the three-point line, 14 turnovers. That goes back to those empty possessions. So if they can settle down here and get into their sets, deal with Duke's pressure, be willing to make the extra pass, not take those frustration shots, they can crawl back. back into this game. So the flip side is Mike Krzyzewski's trying to sustain the energy, right, sustain the intensity. They were so sharp, so crisp. Now the key is, can you do it for 20 more minutes?
Zubek only got a couple of minutes in there. One of the knocks against the Blue Devils was they didn't have that big presence inside, and yet, you know, Duke has beaten teams and is beating another one that is known to have sort of a power guy in the middle. So how are they getting away with that?
Well, they did an effective job collectively having an awareness of where DeJuan Blair was at. And also defensively, I thought they rotated a lot of fresh bodies on Blair. You saw smaller men using their foot speed and quickness down low. And Lance Thomas, a veteran, a capable player down low, a banger. So they do have some capable players. And Kyle Singler presents matchup problems for Pittsburgh. He's a skilled 6'8 guy that can step away from the bucket.
Hammered Wisconsin. Wisconsin known for its big front line. They beat them 82-58 back on the 27th of November. They're winning tonight. We'll find out how the second half plays. And don't forget, first bowl game of the year follows this one.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Dish Network. Get the most HD channels and the best HD DVR available from Dish Network. And Charlie Wilson's War, starring Tom Hanks, Julia Roberts, and Philip Seymour Hoffman, directed by Mike Nichols, starts tomorrow.
And movies in HD free for 6 months. Plus, get a free HD DVR upgrade. Get over 70 national HD channels today, and more on the way with Dish Network.
Charlie Wilson's War has been nominated for 5 Golden Globe Awards, including Best Picture.
Without Charlie, history would be sadly different.
Sometimes you have to be unconventional to accomplish the unbelievable. Charlie Wilson's War, rated R.
Drift away, cause here we're living for today. Let's go out back tonight.
Let go of the day. Go out back tonight. Where fresh salmon is grilled moist and tender, and the steaks are thick and juicy. Come see what's on our holiday grill.
Let's go out back tonight.
This holiday, let go.
Everybody needs a holiday.
Go out back.
Just 5 shopping days left. The perfect gift is Disney DVD. High School Musical 2, the extended edition.
Let's go, let's go, let's go.
Santa Claus 3, the escape clause. And Disney's classic, The Jungle Book.
How delightful.
Bring them home today on Disney DVD and Blu-ray.
Hi, I'm Alan Thicke here in Las Vegas, the most exciting city on earth, with an offer you cannot refuse.
For a limited time, Tahiti Village, the newest 5-star resort in Las Vegas, is offering a complimentary 3-day, 2-night, second honeymoon getaway to Vegas. You'll have the romantic time of your life, and it won't cost you a dime.
You may even stir up a little romantic magic with everything Vegas has to offer. This offer is limited to people who love food, fun, dining, gambling, sports, big shows, big stars, and generally people just loving life. Come on in. The party starts when you get here. Space is limited. Fun is not. It's couples only. It's complimentary. Hey, if you call right now, we'll throw in a pair of tickets to one of those fabulous shows right here on the Strip. What happens in Vegas should be happening to you.
Only a limited number of complimentary packages available. Call this number now for details on this special offer.
Garden. Holiday Hoops on ESPN, presented by K Jewelers, as we go to the second half. It is Duke 34, Pittsburgh 22, in a battle of 10-0 teams. Greg Paulus showing how physical this game has been in the first half. Pittsburgh, other than Levance Fields, had few people finding the range, a ton of turnovers. They missed threes, they missed free throws, they missed dunks, they missed everything. And Duke, very balanced as always.
Well, and Pittsburgh's only down 12. I mean, they get right back in this ball game. If they get a stop and start getting some scores, Pittsburgh is going to have to be stronger with the ball to run their offense and quit taking challenge shots. They are taking a lot of challenge shots that are out of rhythm.
Does DeJuan Blair need more touches on the inside?
I think he does, but one of the first things they've got to do is be more disciplined, to make better cuts, catch the ball, be strong with it. They turned it over 13 times. They only average 12 turnovers per game. but yet they're still right in it.
Blair got a finger on it, but it stays with Duke as we go to Doris Burke.
Guys, the Pitt staff clearly disappointed with those uncharacteristic turnovers. One, poor decisions. Duke's defense had an impact. We said, hey, guys, let's give ourselves a chance to win if we do a better job caring for the basketball and getting to the offensive glass. Let's be a bit more persistent. They feel like their defense was okay, guys.
Henderson misses the dunk, gets it back. Pittsburgh had only two offensive rebounds in the first half. Then again, Duke had only three.
Well, Doris made a great point. Their defense was fine. They only gave up 34 points. They got the tempo they wanted. The key is, are you going to be strong enough with the ball to run your offense to get the shots that you normally get so your offensive rebounders know when they're supposed to go to the glass?
And you think maybe that rim's a little bit higher than 10 feet? I mean, we got some pretty good jumpers who are having trouble dunking at that end tonight.
Well, Gerald Henderson, a magnificent athlete, but... yeah, just didn't get it up high enough, and he can really climb the ladder, and he's got an extra step on it.
That foul was on Lance Thomas, his second. Pittsburgh actually finished the first half, the last minute and a half or so, playing well. Got a couple of stops, scored the last 4 points of the half as Paulus is called for the foul.
Pittsburgh scoring more this year. They're a much more efficient team. They've got more places from which to score. Sam Young at the four, I think a much better scorer than Levon Kendall was last season. DeJuan Blair, a very good scorer inside. And now Ronald Ramon in the starting lineup, who's a terrific shooter, but he hasn't gotten an open look coming off those staggers. Now he's gonna work on the ball and let Levance Fields work off it a little bit.
But just 22 points in 21 minutes tonight for Pitt. And Ramon doing a lot of dribbling, but not really making any progress here.
Well, dribbling the leather off the ball, in part because DeMarcus Nelson doing a good job staying in front.
Blair inside, and he'll go back to the line where he's gotten often tonight, but he has struggled. He is 1-for-5 from the stripe. Nelson is called for the foul.
Once Pittsburgh sees the ball go through the net a couple times, they'll get a better feeling about themselves and maybe get a little bit more rhythm. They just need to have something good happen because, you know, it's not like they're down 25. They're only down 12. Now 11.
Jamie Dixon's team, they're a resilient bunch. They've had some big comebacks in recent years. One of them down by 11 at halftime to Louisville in the Big East tournament last year, and he came back to win the game. Now this is a different group. They've lost some guys. They've added some guys. Blair with a couple of big makes, and it is down to 10.
Look how spread Duke trying to keep the floor. You can see they've run some of these dribble handoffs and dribble exchanges, trying to get that defense to move, especially DeJuan Blair. They want him moving all over the floor. And Mike Krzyzewski not happy with the movement he's seeing offensively and how his team has come out in the second half.
So we'll step aside here early in the second half. The Panthers have got the deficit down to 10.
The NCAA Women's Basketball Championship coming in March.
This is the story of giving my mom what she really wants for the holidays. I don't know if she was more surprised at what I got.
Let me look at you.
Or how good I looked in it. Yep, I'm glad I didn't go with that crystal turtle.
Whatever your story is, your Citi card can help you write it. Citi, let's get it done.
Comfortable in jeans that are tough. I'm comfortable in jeans that fit great. I'm comfortable in Wrangler.
Wrangler 5-star premium denim jeans. Built tough with 14-ounce heavyweight denim. Built comfortable with a stone-washed finish and relaxed fit. Wrangler 5-star premium denim jeans. Satisfaction guaranteed. Wrangler. Real. Comfortable. Jeans.
They want a sequel now. How are we supposed to get in touch with these people?
Watch and learn.
Talk to me.
Sequel's greenlit.
How greenlit?
How green is money?
Yes.
Yes.
Welcome to a network where dream teams happen.
at the push of a button. Cisco, welcome to the human network.
Well, an animated Mike Krzyzewski calling a timeout here early in the second half. Obviously very unhappy with his team. Jay, you've been in these huddles. What's Mike Krzyzewski trying to get across?
Well, Mike Krzyzewski coaches by feel. And one of the things that I've always admired about him is when things are the most crazy, that's when he's the most calm. And when things are a little bit too calm, that's when he can get a little crazy. And he didn't like the way his team looked. He didn't like the way they were walking. He didn't like the way they were communicating and felt they were a little bit too cool out on the sidelines. So he let him have it during that last timeout. We'll see how they respond.
And Steve Wojciechowski to the right of Coach K, also getting in on it. The coaching staff of Duke, Johnny Dawkins, Chris Collins, Steve Wojciechowski, all played for Mike Krzyzewski at Duke.
Two run-out ball screens in a row. Singler slipped the screen, and then Lance Thomas coming out to set another screen. Trying to put the big guys of Pittsburgh in a position to have to defend a ball screen out on the perimeter. Make DeJuan Blair move his feet.
What he has to do right now is he switches off onto Paulus.
Paulus trying to get Gerald Henderson to post Ronald Ramon. I think Paulus needed to take Blair off the dribble.
Now Thomas posting up on Fields. Got help from Blair. And it's Pittsburgh basketball.
Pitt has a great opportunity here. They got to stop. They need to get a score and put some game pressure back on the Blue Devils. Make this a game again where shots really matter every time down.
Going back to the first half, they have scored the last 6 points of the game. Fields.
That's not the shot. That is a challenge shot falling away with Fields shooting over a bigger defender in Kyle Singler. I mean, right now, Pittsburgh isn't able to make a pass to start their offense. And they've got to do a better job of setting up their cuts and being resolute and getting open.
There's shot clock for the Panthers as it's inbounded to Cook, who's had a very quiet night. A wing guy who can score in a variety of ways. Guarded by a bigger defender right now in Thomas.
Duke doing a lot of switching, and it's very difficult for Pittsburgh to find some openings. They've got to try to slip some of these screens.
That's where Cook's really dangerous. He can find room near the basket where none appears to exist.
Well, and he kept his dribble on that possession and stayed strong with it.
It's now an 8-0 run and down to an 8-point lead for Duke.
Well, DeMarcus Nelson got away with a little carry there. Here comes a run-out ball screen.
And here come the Pitt fans making some noise for the first time since early in the game, but they'll be quieted after Thomas lays it in on a sweet feed from Singler.
Boy, what a pass by Kyle Singler. The great awareness as he got into the middle of the lane and read the defense. He's got great eyes and can really see the game.
Fields trying to turn the corner, slips and turns it over.
Now, Dan, some guys look, other guys see. Kyle Singler can see, and this is something you can't teach. As soon as he catches it, immediately looks over that inside shoulder to the middle. He sees that DeJuan Blair comes over to double, and he makes the right pass.
And you said it in the first half, but for those who may not have been with us, he's as well-rounded as any player on this team, as versatile as any player on this team, and he's just a freshman.
Well, he's a complete player. No holes in his game, doesn't need the ball to play.
DeMarcus Nelson for the left hand and count it. Wait, the two officials are going to talk it over. Still no signal. The Pittsburgh players have started walking the other way.
They've called the foul on Pittsburgh.
Yeah, called it on Cook and count the basket.
That's a tough call on Pittsburgh, but a terrific drive by DeMarcus Nelson. He has got a unique ability with his strength and also his length to put the ball on the floor and get that shoulder in front of the defender right around Sam Young. And it looked like Mike Cook was there. Those are awfully difficult calls. But I just wonder which official had. I mean, Mike Kitts blew his whistle. I mean, what was his call? Why did they have to have a discussion?
And now each team going over to the bench. Now what could this be about? We know we have to assume it's on Cook. He was the guy who tried to take the charge, so what are they reviewing?
They might be reviewing exactly who the foul is on. Yeah, you can review it for a scorer's or a timer's error. So Mike Kitt saying that he had the charge call and Jamie Lucky had the call on a foul from behind the play. Well, what happened first?
It's not Cook. They're trying to figure out who the other defender was. It should be Sam Young, I guess, is who they're going to call the foul on.
So essentially Jamie Lucky is coming in saying, look, I had the call before the charge. And it must be on the only guy there was Sam Young.
It is Sam Young, who they've given the foul to. So count the basket and the foul on Young. They went to the monitor to see which Panther it was. Jamie Dixon,
wow,
predictably that, not happy.
That is a rough call for Pittsburgh. I mean, guy there to take the charge. I mean, if it was before the charge, you'd think it might also be before the shot.
Three-point play for Nelson, an unhappy Jamie Dixon, his team down by 13 after getting it down to 8 moments ago. Pittsburgh, a team that has scored well this year, better than 80 points per game, but held to 26 so far tonight. Cook.
Great rotation by the Duke keeper.
Fields misses the three. Pittsburgh still ice cold from beyond the arc, and now we've got a call going against Duke. It'll be David McClure.
Got McClure on the hold as that ball was in the air, but Pittsburgh did a good job reading the defense after the drive, and it was shut off by the really solid help side rotation, but they did knock down an open shot. I mean, you get open shots, you got to knock them down, especially in a big time environment.
And Pittsburgh is just 1 for 9 from beyond the arc.
I mean, there is way too much talking right now. The officials are trying to explain everything. I mean, if you made the right call, let's just play.
I think that last one, I think the PA announcer announced the foul on Henderson, number 15, and it was corrected to be on McClure, number 14.
Another switch. These Duke defenders, very versatile.
Again, Blair not getting a lot of touches in the offense for Pitt right now.
He hasn't gotten any, and he's got to be a little bit more aggressive calling for the ball. That was a smart job by Ronald Ramon to use Nelson's aggressiveness against him.
Foul on Nelson. Well, we know what the Duke basketball program has achieved in recent years. Is the football program about to turn the corner? We'll hear from the Blue Devils' new coach when we come back.
During the Big Seafood Festival, come in for our biggest seafood of the year, rock lobster tail, king crab legs, and try the biggest shrimp we've ever served, colossal shrimp, at Red Lobster. Come see what's fresh today.
Rated R, Tuesday.
You never know what part of the internet you'll need. The should you take sunblock part. The how's traffic to the airport part. The what about an ocean view room part. Or the can you really afford this part. Which is why all the parts of the internet are on the iPhone.
The passage is intense, but if you complete the journey, you will find your destiny among the world's greatest warriors. The few, the proud, the Marines.
Can I help you?
Oh, I'm just going down my holiday gift list one last time, see if there's anybody I've missed.
And is there?
Yes.
Who?
Everybody.
Last-minute holiday shopping? Come to Lowe's and get 20% off all power tool combo kits, 20% off all in-stock small kitchen appliances, 10% off all shop vacs, 10% off all Whirlpool and Maytag appliances, plus free in-stock delivery in time for Christmas. And for the gift that's right for everybody, pick up a Lowe's gift card.
Get everybody?
Got everybody.
Lowe's, let's build something together.
Back to the college football basketball in just a second. Football score, Steelers leading the Rams, Roethlisberger an early touchdown, 7-0. As they play the first. We'll have more on this coming up during the halftime of the college football bowl game. Back to you, Dan. back here in New York. Duke leading Pittsburgh in the first meeting between these two programs in 28 years. Again, we know what Duke basketball has been all about the last quarter century. Is the football program headed in the right direction? They've got a new boss in David Cutcliffe, who's standing by with Doris Burke.
And a coach who's always been associated with some of the best programs in the country. And I guess, Coach, the first question people would want to know is, why Duke?
Well, it's about people first. Everywhere I turned, I ran into people that I thought were winners and hungry. And I'm kind of hungry to do this. I'm looking forward to this challenge.
You were supposed to meet with Mike Krzyzewski for about 15 minutes. That turned into an hour. What did he say that impressed you about what Duke could be from a football standpoint?
Well, Mike's intensity impressed me first about Duke University. And one of the things that he let me know in a hurry, he said, it's been no gravy train. But he said, I can tell you how we can earn it here. You got something great to sell. He said, you just have to be willing to go compete. But when he talked, he kind of challenged me to compete. That got me excited. That's what we're all in this for. But I understood the Duke mission after I talked to Mike Krzyzewski.
This is a program, and you speak of competing, that has only won four games in 4 years. What kind of timetable are you envisioning to get this team maybe bowl eligible?
I've never been very patient, and I don't plan to be here now. And I'm excited about getting up and running. We've got some good football players. We do. We've got some holes to fill, but we've never gone into anything. I'm going to bring in some great people, never gone into anything that we're going to wait and make it happen. We're going in with a goal to make that happen the first year, and I'm really looking forward to starting spring practice and see where we've got to get to.
Coach, thanks for joining us. Good luck.
Thank you.
All right, Doris, thank you very much. Well, Jay, again, as a Duke grad, what do you think Duke football is capable of?
Well, they're certainly capable of more than one win per season. But, you know, Doris asked David Cutcliffe about a timetable. And I always go back to what John McKay said when he took over the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, that he had a five-year plan. They asked him why, and he said, because I got a five-year contract. I got a four-year contract. I got a four-year plan.
Well, let's see if things get better for the Duke football program after struggling for so many years. Sam Young, Jawan Blair, and a whistle before the shots. Tonight, speaking of college football, Capital One Bowl Week kicks off here on ESPN with over 20 games in 12 days on the ESPN family of networks. It opens with Utah and Navy tonight in the San Diego County Credit Union. Poinsettia Bowl right after us tonight right here on ESPN.
Right now, it's taken Pittsburgh two or three dribbles when they're putting the ball on the floor to get anywhere near the basket. The one success they had was running that high ball screen to try to spread it out a little bit. That's another bad shot. You got a fall away jumper in the middle of the lane by Mike Cook. Those are low percentage looks for Pittsburgh.
Another Duke foul, though. About the only thing that's not going well for Duke right now is all the fouls they're accumulating, but Pittsburgh can't capitalize.
Mike Cook putting it on the floor. I mean, get it to the rim. You know, that fall away shot is a difficult shot. I mean, this team's only down by 11 points. I mean, it's just under 15 minutes. There's a long way to go, and you got to get better shots than that.
And Pitt is in the bonus already. 5 minutes and 10 seconds into the second half. That's the seventh foul on Duke.
And that means be strong with the ball. You'll get rewarded with free throws. When you put it on the floor, look for contact. Seek out bodies and be prepared to take a bump and finish a play. I mean, Pittsburgh has done everything they've wanted to do on the defensive end. They've gotten the tempo they wanted. They just haven't been strong in their half-court offense to run their offense the way they know how to.
Blair finding the range at the line here in the second half. Holiday Hoops on ESPN, presented by K Jewelers here at Madison Square Garden in New York City. Duke and Pittsburgh. Dan Shulman, Jay Bilas, Doris Burke. Glad you're along with us. Henderson with a deep jumper.
Well, Kyle Singler was open off that slip on the screen. A very difficult shot by Gerald Henderson, but knocks it down and makes it look easy.
Taking a while for Pittsburgh to get something started, to find any opening in this Duke defense. They go into the big guy.
In the wrong way. Yeah, wide open in the middle and turn back into the defense.
Shire ahead to King. And a Duke turnover.
Taylor King, not a good turnover, and Mike Krzyzewski very upset. You can see Blair. He had an easy layup with his left hand if he had just turned in. He had Singler caught on his left side, and rather than feel that, he made a freshman mistake and turned back into the defense and made his shot a lot more difficult.
Is that perhaps, Jay, a case of the double teams he saw in the first half? He knows those are going to come from the middle of the floor?
That's part of it, but Kyle Singler did a pretty smart thing. He jumped off of him instead of staying contact, keeping body contact, so he couldn't feel him. And that's one of the reasons that he made that mistake. He needs to look over that shoulder and feel it.
Blair out, Tyrell Biggs in now for Pitt. Benjamin, the floater is way short. Biggs working hard on the interior. Brown got a finger on it, but again, Pittsburgh missing all kinds of opportunities.
It looked like Pittsburgh was expecting contact, not giving up an open three.
Shire misses an open three in the rebound of the Panthers.
Well, Pittsburgh having every opportunity to get back in this. They just need to take advantage of some of these situations.
And they do right there. Young from Brown, and Young's headed to the line as well.
That's what Pittsburgh is going to have to do. After they get a miss, immediately look up court and try to beat Duke down the floor to get something quick and get something easy, because they're not getting anything against Duke's half-court defense. You can see Benjamin trying to bring the ball up, passing ahead, and Duke's transition defense very slow, nobody communicating. Guys with their backs to what's going on. And right now, Kyle Singler, a little upset with himself for not being more aware in transition defense and talking.
And he sits down with his third foul. Nolan Smith has also come back in. Zubek has come back in. They're out there with Nelson, Shire, and King. And Pittsburgh again back within eight.
And a great opportunity here for Pittsburgh to get a stop.
Fields stepping it up out on the perimeter against Smith, the freshman. Nice look to Shire. The pull-up from inside the arc, not there. Benjamin for three. And they just won't go down from beyond the arc. Zubek, the seven-footer, brings down the rebound.
Boy, what a rebound by Zubek. And that was a terrific pass by Levance Fields.
Shire baseline. Left hand. No! Having a tough night, but he gets a steal! And count the basket, goaltending.
Boy, what a big mistake by Pittsburgh. Defensively very fortunate to come away there, grabbing a defensive board, and then they just cough it up. An uncharacteristic turnover for the Panthers.
First field goal of the night for Shire. Ramon back into the game, and now for Pitt. And Fields, who has been at the waist tugging at his shorts, a little bit tired, he'll come out.
He's had to work so hard just to get an offense started. And for Pittsburgh, Dan, the story has been opportunities wasted. They have had a number of opportunities. A great read and drive by Shire, just couldn't get it to go down. And then Shire, very aware, look how he doubles back there and steals that pass and really takes advantage of Young letting his guard down.
So now Ramon has to operate at the point. He's more of a two guard, but he's playing at the point right now for Fields. Young, no, but Biggs in the right place at the right time to lay it in.
Pittsburgh just looks uncomfortable in breakdown situations. When they can't get into their normal offense, they don't have the kind of guys that are one-on-one performers that are going to get their own shot.
And their point guard Fields and their center Blair are both on the bench right now. Number two on to Gilbert Brown. I would venture to say it's not been often this year where both Fields and Blair have been out of the game at the same time in a meaningful part of the game for Pitt.
Well, having Fields out takes the handler away, makes Ronald Ramon the point guard.
And now Blair's getting ready to come back in.
You know, Pittsburgh has been lifting up on some shot fakes. Duke may be able to give a shot fake and go around once they catch it.
Smith is fouled on the drive. It'll be Ramon, his second.
You have got to play defense with your feet against Duke. When they spread the floor and put it on the deck, it is so easy to instinctively reach your hands out to try to give yourself a little extra help in guarding. And the referees are going to call that almost every time.
Last time these two programs met was the year before Mike Krzyzewski took over as head coach of the Blue Devils. You've got to go back to 1979. King the miss and a good rebound in traffic by Brown, who looks like he's going to give Pittsburgh some good minutes this year after a medical redshirt a year ago. Biggs on the wing. And it rattles out. Offensive rebound and a foul.
Well, Taylor King has got the range to shoot it from deep, but he took that three from the NBA line. I think some of the players have gravitated too much toward that line.
Pittsburgh back within eight with a ton of time still to go here in the Garden.
The new Philips Norelco Architect, A shaver with flexible heads which pivot and rotate freely to give you a great shave even on the neck. Simplicity is making hard-to-reach places easy to reach.
Balls of Fury. Bring it home for the holidays today.
Kicks off tonight as Utah battles Navy at 9 Eastern on ESPN.
Dan McDermott and Tommy White were released earlier today, having served just 6 months of a one-year sentence.
You've been abandoned by the powers that be, and there's nowhere else to turn. You count for nothing, and your cries fall on deaf ears. I've got the confidence to fight back.
Because you want to do something about it.
What are you doing here?
To learn how to fight.
The law failed him.
We won't.
Fios TV On Demand brings you thousands of the hottest shows and movies anytime you want.
Now available on demand. Everywhere this thing goes, 8 days later, the planet dies.
How do you fight something that can eat planets?
Leave that to me.
I'm so hot for you right now.
Me too!
Fios TV On Demand brings you thousands of the hottest shows and movies anytime you want.
Carl Ravitch in our Sports Center 30 at 30 studios. Bill Parcells signs a four-year contract Thursday. Hopes to lead the Dolphins back to respectability. He's got a proven track record of success, says the owner, Wayne Huizenga, who also said he will not sell the team. Back to the basketball in a second. Want to let you know that the Steelers are now tied with the Rams 7-7. Najee Davenport, now the running back, as Willie Parker was taken off the field on a golf cart. We'll get an update on that later. Carl back here with the Garden. Time now for our game track, presented by PlayStation 3. A low-scoring, physical affair with Pittsburgh, especially not executing their offense well at time, but also just missing some open looks. Let's bring in Doris Burke.
Well, this guy, an expressive, competitive young man. As he went to break, guys, he was trying to incite the fans behind the bench. He started motioning to them like, hey, let's get involved. Jamie Dixon said early in the year, as preseason workouts started, the upperclassmen started to notice this guy was the first one in the gym. So they took notice. A little bit of competition was created. Everybody getting in the gym a little bit early. There he is, trying to get everybody fired up. I asked him about being undersized. He said, it's not a concern for me. I have a 7'3" wingspan and my heart's big. I'm not scared of anybody. I like his approach, Jay.
He reminds you a little bit of Glenn Big Baby Davis, not only with the infectious smile, but as Glenn Davis used to say, 320 takes its toll. And even though Blair is not that big, he can take his toll after a while.
Nelson to miss off the fingertips of Blair, right back to DeMarcus Nelson. And a foul before the shot. Well, the 6'7" guy, but as we mentioned, a wingspan of 7'2 or 7'3, so he can spread out wide and he can grab some rebounds out of his area.
Well, you can see his wingspan here. People accuse me of using the term long too much, but 7'3 when you're 6'7 is awfully long, and it's really hard to find shirts, too.
And he's a guy, again, a Pittsburgh product. He started going to the Pitt basketball camp, 7th, 8th grade. So he's been on the radar of the Panther program for a number of years. Nolan Smith couldn't finish, and here come the Panthers. They are inching closer. Benjamin from the elbow. It's a 5-point game.
And Pittsburgh getting their best looks and their most effective scoring opportunities off their defense. They are turning defense into offense.
Duke with just 9 points here in the second half.
Now Pittsburgh has got the exact tempo it wants, and that was a bad shot by DeMarcus Nelson.
But a foul going against the Panthers. It'll be Biggs.
Pittsburgh getting right back in this. Benjamin pulls up. DeMarcus Nelson doing a really good job of forcing the pull-up jump shot. And this is a really tough shot. Your momentum carrying you forward, but nothing but net for Keith Benjamin. Solid performance.
Benjamin, a senior from nearby Mount Vernon, New York, has been a role player his entire time at Pittsburgh, considered transferring a couple of times earlier in his career, but has stuck it out and has been a valuable performer off the bench over the years for the Panthers.
You know, it's funny, there's so many kids that consider transferring at one time or another. College basketball is tough, and when it doesn't always go your way, you know, you often think about, you know, maybe this other program recruited me hard. They appreciated me, but Keith Benjamin has stuck it out. And he's been a really valuable contributor, especially on the defensive end. Really good defender.
Singler at the line for Duke. 9 points on the night for Singler. The Duke co-leaders right now are Henderson and Nelson, each with 10. And that's been the story of the year offensively for the Blue Devils. They've got five players in double figures.
Well, good job by Nelson to keep that thing alive.
Wow. Over the back goes Shire. If the ball is anywhere near DeJuan Blair, as you mentioned before, length and strength, it's his ball.
Well, you know, we talk about length a lot, and I often talk about how long a player is. I don't care how tall a guy is. I want to know how long he is, because that was not grabbed with height. That was grabbed with length. You can see that 7'3 wingspan going high in the air, and he's got great hands. And John Shire just going over the back. Every time that Pittsburgh is strong and they get fouled, they're going to shoot free throws the rest of the way. That's one way for them to get back into this thing.
And they're going to shoot two the rest of the way. That is the 10th team foul on Duke. Pitt's over the limit as well. They've committed seven here in a foul-plagued second half.
And another missed opportunity for Pittsburgh.
Blair with some big games recently and the wins over Washington, Oklahoma State, but he misses a couple of critical free throws. He's just 5 of 13 from the line in this game.
You know, Dan, when you're having a hard time scoring and you get a chance to go to the free throw line and knock a couple down, when you miss them, it's really deflating.
Nelson, left hand. And another rebound for Blair. That is 12 on the night.
There have been no second shots for Duke unless they've been able to tip one out to a teammate. Blair has just controlled everything in the paint.
Fields getting set to check back in for the Panthers as we near the midway mark of the second half.
Blair's got a lockdown inside. He can really get an angle on Singler and get the ball.
Ramon, another bad shot. And Blair to the floor with Singler. And it's going to be an intentional foul on DeJuan Blair.
Well, DeJuan Blair was hung up with Singler, and then it looked like he just got his right arm on Singler and pulled him down. And checking on the replay, so you can see they get tied up a little bit here, and he puts that left arm. That was a takedown, no question about it. Right arm around his throat, left arm, excuse me, around his throat, and just pulls him down. That's a good call.
Jamie Lucky making the call. That'll give Duke two free throws and the ball.
Playing in a two-possession game. That's a big turn of events and not a very smart play. More of a frustration foul by the freshman, DeJuan Blair. And you can see how strong he is as well. And that was like a horse collar tackle, the kind that Roy Williams got suspended for at the Dallas Cowboys.
Well, right off the top of the show, Jay, you said Mike Krzyzewski told his team this morning, this is going to be a man's game. And it has been a slugfest here tonight.
And Kyle Singler stepping up like a man to hit a big free throw. And, you know, it's very difficult after you get thrown to the floor, and especially with nobody around you on the lane, to step up and knock down free throws.
And he knocks down the second as well. And it's Duke ball.
Now, this is a huge possession for Pittsburgh. They need to get a stop here to give up a 4 or maybe 5 point play when they had an opportunity to cut it to 4 or 3 would be a gigantic turnaround.
Anderson defended out of the wing right now by Blair. Now they switch Fields on Henderson, and Blair's guarding Paulus. Now more switching.
And trying to keep it spread. Now they're going to pull it back out in the last 14 seconds and call a set. Run out ball screen. He slips it again.
Paulus into Singler, and he scores right over Blair. 13 for Kyle Singler.
That was a 6, maybe 7 point turnaround.
Brown for 3. Rebound Blair in the putback.
Boy, their best offense has been a missed shot. Boy, how about Kyle Singler and how smart of a player he is? Slipping screens, always looking for the ball. He slipped another one. That's putting a lot of pressure on this Pittsburgh defense. That was a bad shot.
Anderson to miss. Blair yet another rebound. He's on his way to a monster night on the glass. Young at the other end and counts. without the basket.
Pittsburgh really doing a good job in transition. That was a very impressive answer when this game could have gotten away from them. And Gerald Henderson maybe let Pitt a little bit off the hook with a bad shot.
And this is a play that Pittsburgh doesn't try a year ago. They don't have the same kind of personnel. Young, if he's in there, isn't as healthy and active. And now the Pitt fans, who are outnumbered here by Duke fans, appear to be the more vocal group right now here in the Garden.
And this last 8:40 is going to be about toughness. Which team is tougher, mentally and physically?
Great shot fade.
Shire for three. And another rebound for Blair.
Guy's a vacuum.
He has sucked up 15 rebounds tonight, and Fields pounding his chest as he buries a three.
Now we've got a heavyweight fight. You know, Pittsburgh, that's a winning culture over there on that sideline, and they do not give up.
A 7-0 run for the Panthers. One of the toughest and most successful programs in the country in recent years, and they've got what was a double-figure deficit down to three with a ton of time to go.
And again, doing it in transition. A wide-open shot for John Shire. Nobody picks up the ball. You can see Greg Paul is playing a little bit too far in the lane. And Levance Fields, he knows they are back in this game. It's now a one-possession game when it could have easily gotten away from him after that intentional foul by DeJuan Blair.
Again, remember, both of these teams are top 10. Both of these teams are undefeated. We've got another one of those coming your way Saturday at noon Eastern right here on ESPN. Jay Doris and I will be in Memphis. Number four, Hoyas. Number two, Tigers. Should be a lot of fun. And among the other great games on Saturday, another top 10 matchup as Texas takes on Michigan State in the Palace of Auburn Hills.
Saturday is going to be a couch potatoes dream. If we weren't in Memphis, I'd be on my couch. What another great steal by Blair.
Wow, what a play by the big guy.
You know, right now, Pittsburgh is just stronger. They're just stronger.
Physically or mentally?
Both. I mean, they absorbed a big blow, and they came back with a huge haymaker.
And they've got a chance to take the lead.
And they've done it without running great offense. They've done it by being tougher.
Looking for the big fella. And an offensive foul. And you give DeMarcus Nelson for a senior play right there. The foul on Blair, his third. But we've got a game. Let's go to Carl.
All right, Dan, thank you very much. Very, very exciting there. Daryl Mack getting set over 100 yards per game. First of 23 bowl games to be seen on the family of networks. It comes up next, but don't go anywhere.
Hey, guys.
Thanks, Dan.
We have a little announcement to make.
Jared has five times the selection of ordinary jewelry stores with thousands of loose diamonds and hundreds of settings to create your own one-of-a-kind ring.
He went to Jared.
I know. He went to Jared. Jared, the Galleria of Jewelry.
Unwrap the holidays with an all-new American Pie movie loaded with laughs and raunchy fun.
How are the ladies treating you?
I won't be doing that.
American Pie presents...
You want to see something?
Beta House Unrated. Get it on DVD Sunday.
Your Double Deep Pizza with double the toppings.
Double. Pizza Hut's new Double Deep Pizza. Double it up with double the toppings and 50% more cheese. Get one now for just $12.99. Double means more with America's favorite pizza, Pizza Hut. Order online.
At T. Rowe Price, successful investing is about balancing risk and reward intelligently. For each 3, 5, and 10-year period, over 70% of our mutual funds beat the Lipper average, finding the right opportunity. Low-cost mutual funds from T. Rowe Price. Invest with confidence. Request a complete prospectus or profile with investment objectives, risks, fees, expenses, and other information to read and consider carefully before investing.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by K Jewelers. Every kiss begins with K.
This ESPN telecast is available in high definition on ESPN HD, presented by Olivia. Well, as they say, game on here in the Garden. Pittsburgh is right back into it within a single point of Duke, 48-47. It was a time, Jay, we said, boy, Blair's going to get more touches. He's getting them, and he's creating them himself as well.
Well, he's only gotten credited for one steal, Dan, but he's been responsible for four or five because he's knocking the ball away, getting deflections. Then when he got it down here, look, I'm a big believer that in order to draw a charge, you have to be knocked down. That was a smart play by DeMarcus Nelson, but let's be straight. He fell down. You know, that was an acting job, and DeJuan Blair needs to be a little bit smarter with the way he uses his body there, because he allowed DeMarcus Nelson to flop on him and get the call.
So, again, there's the charge on Blair recently, just a couple of minutes ago, the intentional foul on Blair. Other than those two situations, he's had a great night. He has not shot free throws well, but he's got 14 points, 15 rebounds. He sits down with three. Henderson travels, and again, Pittsburgh's got a chance to take the lead.
Well, DeJuan Blair trying to get the crowd into the game, keep his teammates up. And you can see he's just got boundless energy, yeah, even when he's on the bench.
He's going to be a fun one for us to watch. And there have been a lot of really fun players to watch in the Pitt program the last several years. And Blair is going to be the next one. A block by Henderson on Young. Here comes Nelson. One-on-one with Brown. And it's an offensive foul. Nelson using that off arm.
Well, I'll tell you what. DeMarcus Nelson made a spectacular defensive play on the other end, but gave it away with using that off arm. Terrific job. Look how he comes over to stop that drive and let Gerald Henderson make the block. But that's not much of a call there. You know, he did put that arm out. I don't know that it was necessarily that much of an effect.
So it is number four on Nelson, and he goes to the bench. We've still got better than 7 minutes to go. Pittsburgh's only lead in this game was 2-0.
Look how far out Pittsburgh again, forced on the floor.
Fields sheds his defender but misses the shot, and the rebound comes down to Singler.
Henderson almost going over the back of Tyrell Biggs.
We'll see how long Jamie Dixon leaves Blair on the bench. Sam Young's had a quiet night tonight for the Panthers.
Henderson can take Biggs.
Young trying to stay with him.
Duke's not moving the ball. Now they're calling a set called circle.
Here comes Shire off a screen. Can't get free. Shot clock at six.
Well, Pittsburgh so good staying in front of the handler.
Shot clock at two. Desperation shot and another Duke turnover.
Like, such a strong defensive stand by Pittsburgh, and Duke really couldn't get anything going. They called two different sets on that play. Didn't get into anything.
And now Jamie Dixon has loaded up. Cook is back. Ramon is back. And Blair is back as he and Singler share a joke down at the other end of the floor. Boy, he is. What is DeJuan Blair is fun.
What does it take to knock a smile off that guy's face? I mean, he's in the middle of a tense environment in a physical, tough game, and you're seeing nothing but white chiclets out there, yep, from him. Having fun is doing hard things well. And DeJuan Blair does hard things well, like rebound and block shots.
Pass in his feet from Cook. And it will stay with Pittsburgh, 9 to shoot.
DeJuan Blair has, what, 15 rebounds in this game? I mean, he has dominated the glass. And Pittsburgh bringing Duke back to them on the field goal percentage side.
How about holding Duke to two fast break points and Pittsburgh's three-point shooting anemic, or they'd be leading.
Right there, Mike Cook was worried about somebody coming over and getting a charge, and he wound up missing an easy shot as a result of it. He was expecting a rotation that never came, and he should have taken that thing in to dunk. Instead, he took it in delicately, worried about a charge.
He did graze the rim, so the shot clock reset. Again, the only lead for Pittsburgh tonight, 2-0. Can they take it again right now? Ramon's got himself an open look. Cook to follow. And Blair will go to the line.
Blair has just been absolutely dominant. Duke has not had an answer for him on the glass. You'd almost to box him out. You'd almost have to play a box and one with the box on Blair.
Number four on Kyle Singler. And Singler's been a very effective player tonight for Duke. And if you're Pittsburgh, you got to believe they're going to start pounding the ball inside as much as they can to try to get Singler out of the game. Singler keeps looking around as if he thinks the call was made on him in error.
Now, Singler was talking. They were talking about being in the right slot. Nolan Smith had pushed Sam Young down a slot, and he got into Kyle Singler's area. So they're really arguing over real estate right now, but really didn't matter on the first of two shots. Now it matters.
They're still talking it over, Singler and Young. One of two for Blair. Offensive rebound. And Young fouled on the floor. Lance Thomas is called for the foul. And right now, Pittsburgh looks like they want it a little bit more.
Well, Dan, this is where the higher slots on the free throw line really help an offensive rebounder. I think the teams are going to start scheming this. You can see Sam Young just gets his elbow into Kyle Singler and leverages his way into the middle. He has much more space this year than he would have had last year to get into the lane.
Pittsburgh leads for the first time since 2-0. Why the change, Shea? Why did they clear out the lower slot?
Well, I think that the rules committee thought that it would clean up play. And I think what it's going to do is make it harder for the lower slot guy, the defensive rebounder, to get a box out, because you're going to see guys spin and you're going to have a wide open middle, and it's going to start getting more physical rather than less.
It is a 12-0 run for Pittsburgh. And the Pitt fans are on their feet. The Pitt bench is on its feet. Can Duke respond?
And this game has been one punch in the mouth after another. What an effort by Pittsburgh to come back.
A team that doesn't mind getting punched in the mouth every now and again, as long as they can return the favor. Smith, tough one. Young with a rebound.
Well, they are so physical on drives right now. They are bumping every cut and staying in front of the handler and making the handler go through them rather than around.
Duke, which has averaged 89 points per game, they've only got 48 tonight. They've only got 14 points in the second half.
And right now for Duke, they don't have a very athletic driving team on the floor. This is not a team that is going to break down offensively.
Guess who with a rebound, but Blair misses one from in close. And we've got a call going against the Panthers. Now, this one at times has felt like a football game. We've got some actual football coming up after us. Capital One Bowl Week here on ESPN. The kickoff between Utah and Navy in the San Diego Credit Union Poinsettia Bowl is at 9:12, about 14 minutes from now.
I think as we get to the under 4 minute timeout, you'll see Mike Krzyzewski make some substitutions, because this is not an athletic team he's got on the floor right now. It's not a team that's going to beat you off the dribble.
McClure missed. Double bonus the rest of the way for both teams. And now here they come. Henderson, Singler, who's got four, and Nelson.
Well, he bought a little bit of time. But that lineup was not going to get to the rim. And this one can. Although it's been difficult for any lineup over the last 6 minutes.
McClure, who battled injuries, had off-season knee surgery, still not 100%. Your prototypical glue guy as he knocks down the free throw. Now he'll sit down, and here comes Nelson. And both coaches appear to have the lineups on the floor that they want now for the last 4 minutes and 37 seconds.
And this could wind up, Dan, coming down to a free throw shooting contest. Both teams in the double bonus every time there's a common foul. Two shots.
And keep in mind, Singler covering Blair, and Singler's got four fouls.
I think they need to go to Blair, not just because of Singler, but because he's an effective finisher.
Fields, it's a three. Shire and Cook battling for the rebound. The ball will stay at this end of the floor. Let's go to Doris Burke.
Guys, outside of the Big East corridor, not sure people know that Jamie Dixon has fashioned the nation's fifth winningest program since 2001. So they played in a lot of big games, but Ronald Ramon told me earlier today, listen, this is a little bit different, clearly, with the 10 Final Fours and the 3 national championships. Having spent our childhood watching Duke, it is a little bit different. First 20 minutes, Jay, they got knocked on their heels, didn't respond. Their attitude totally different here in the second.
Well, I think that's exactly right, Doris. And they got the tempo they wanted. They've had it all game long and have forced it, especially on the defensive end. They've been much more resolute on the offensive end in the second half, and they've taken a little bit better advantage of their opportunities, especially in transition. But, you know, this is a team, they're never going to give up. Good pass. Oh, what a recovery by Singler.
Inside the final 4 minutes, 14 on the shot clock. Pittsburgh with the ball and a one-point lead. Number 7 Duke, number 9 Pitt. Each team 10-0 on the season. Fields off the glass and good.
Well, using DeJuan Blair as a screener with that run-out ball screen, that's awfully hard to get around, and Levance Fields can get a step.
At the other end, Singler with a miss. Cook rips down the rebound.
Well, that's a shot that Kyle Singler can and needs to finish because DeJuan Blair came over and changed it. He needs to take that up to dunk and get contact.
Nelson and Singler on the floor with Duke for Duke with four fouls. Ramon puts it on the floor. 15-footer, no good.
Well, it looks like Pittsburgh is expecting somebody to jump out and take a charge. They're floating a little bit on these shots.
Henderson slithers all the way to the goal. A dozen for Gerald Henderson.
Well, that's the athletic driver that Duke needed to have on the floor that they didn't have on the floor for a 2 or 3 minute stretch.
And a 30-second timeout. Both coaches were calling for one. I believe it has been charged to Pittsburgh.
See Levance Fields getting Paulus to go underneath that screen. Not worried about the shot, but just allowed him to turn the corner, and Fields with that strength. And you can see what a great crossover. Mike Cook needs to come over a lot stronger to stop an athlete the caliber of Gerald Henderson from getting to the rim.
What a comeback by Pittsburgh here in the second half. They have been stronger, tougher in the second half than they were in the first. They haven't shot the ball that much better. They shot it terribly in the first half. They've done a little bit better in the second half, and their defense has really locked down the Blue Devils.
Well, they're a great defensive team. They stand you up on your cuts. They're very physical. They limit you to one shot. And I think what's paramount right now, I mean, this is now a three-minute game. I mean, we had a grinder for so long. It's still going to be a grinder down the stretch, but now every possession is critical, and there is tremendous game pressure on these players. And the team that steps forward and grabs big defensive rebounds, that's stronger with the ball, that steps to the line and hits big free throws, is going to come out with a great win for their resume.
Two teams which love playing in this building. Duke comes here pretty much every year, usually around the holidays, and plays a big name opponent, a Texas, a Gonzaga, now a Pittsburgh. Pitt, of course, plays here occasionally during the regular season when they take on St. John's, and each and every year in the Big East tournament. So two teams that love coming here and have had a lot of success in this building.
Pittsburgh has had some success with Blair coming out and setting a ball screen. But it's going to be Young out here.
Now with Paulus on him. And it will stay with Pitt as we go to a timeout. It has not been a masterpiece at times, but it has been hotly contested. A lot of emotion here in the Garden tonight.
Okay, delivery intercept. Well, say you just shipped the package to New York and it's on its way when your customer calls and says, hey, I gotta run down to DC for a few days. Well, now what? Well, what if you could intercept the package and have it sent back? Or better yet, reroute it to DC? Well, you'd have those options if you shipped with UPS. It's not just delivery, it's UPS delivery intercept. Oh, good. Cherry blossoms are out.
Came to get along.
And I'm getting a massage.
I want you to whisper your name in my ear.
Mordecai. Ah! Two friends just hit a new low.
I'm not robbing no church. I'm talking about robbing the people in the church.
On January 11th, their plan doesn't have a prayer.
All we want is the money.
You got a gun? God gonna whip your...
First Sunday, rated PG-13.
Make a move, I'll pop a cap in your...
You don't need to be scared. He ain't got that many bullets.
In theaters everywhere, January 11th.
You know, HD TV and TiVo HD just belong together. Like me and Duke. I mean, why get a premium HD TV and a generic DVR? My TiVo searches for HD by show, actor, team, and downloads thousands of movies right to my TV. And Duke, he gets me other things.
Oh, he's so cute.
Good boy, Duke.
New TiVo Ho Ho HD. Perfect for the holidays.
ABC. your NBA destination for a Christmas Day doubleheader. First, unwrap a duel between two of the game's superstars as Dwayne Wade leads the Heat against King James and the Cavaliers. Then, a bitter rivalry is renewed when Steve Nash and the Fiery Suns battle the Lakers.
Beautiful move from Kobe Bryant.
NBA Christmas Day doubleheader. Heat Cavs and Suns Lakers. Coverage begins at 2 Eastern on ABC.
College football seconds away. Kick will be at 9:12 Eastern time. Reggie Campbell over 150 per game. Utah and Navy start the bowl week and the bowl season right here. Meantime, trying to get to a Super Bowl or at least the playoffs, the Steelers behind two Ben Roethlisberger touchdowns to Washington. They're up 17-14. Willie Parker done for the game with an ankle injury.
Carl here, just over 2.5 minutes to go. Holiday Hoops presented by K Jewelers. Glad you're with us tonight at Madison Square Garden. It has been, as expected, a bit of a slugfest. Pittsburgh with the pace it has wanted and a big comeback here in the second half to take the lead as Fields drives to the bucket and will head to the line.
Just attacking Kyle Singler off the switch. And it looked like Paulus came over and got him as he was putting the shot up. But look at it. It's like a bowling ball rolling downhill. How do you stop him?
And you can see the effects, the physical nature of what Paulus has been through tonight. Two of the more successful programs in America recently. Each is 10-0 this year. Each has been very successful going to the tournament each of the last 6 years. Duke has been to the Sweet 16 five times in the last 6 years. That's the most of anybody in the nation. And then a group of schools has been there four times, including Pitt.
Well, Duke's been on essentially a 20-year run, and Pittsburgh has been on an unbelievable seven-year streak. And Ben Howland and Jamie Dixon built this program on toughness behind guys like Brandon Knight and Jerron Brown and Julius Page and Chevy Troutman. And they've got another tough group here.
Henderson with a slam. Athleticism trumping toughness on that play.
Everybody sticking with their man. There was nobody coming over with help side defense.
Inside, 2 minutes to go. Pitt with the ball and a one-point lead. We've got a chant of let's go Pitt, and we've got a chant of defense here in the Garden. The Duke fans outnumbering the Pitt fans. Young, off balance, but good.
Wow, he has got gymnastic ability. Almost a ballet move there with strength.
13 for Young. Oh! Singler at the other end to tie it.
There is just answer after answer.
Well, what did we say earlier? Each coach kind of wanted to simulate a Sweet 16, Elite Eight kind of a feel. They've got it right now.
They've been simulating a heavyweight fight. And one punch by Gerald Henderson. A two-handed haymaker right to the solar plexus. And then Singler on the other end. Stepping out the drive. The defense collapses, stepping into his shot. And that is as pretty as you're going to see it.
16 for the freshman as we go to Doris Burke.
Well, Mike Krzyzewski told his guys this morning at Shoot a Ground, be aggressive with your instincts. You don't win big games by holding back. You win by being aggressive. Well, boom, there's one aggressive play. He also made the drive and the kick to Singler. That is two big plays following your coach's advice, Jay.
Well, and they've been aggressive on both ends. Pittsburgh has answered every call. And they've been putting the ball on the floor and seeking out contact and finishing plays. I mean, it has been one play after another over the last 10 minutes of this game.
Double bonus both ways, each team with a one timeout. What does this kind of a game in December do for a quality team in March?
Oh, it is a huge help because, one, it identifies some weaknesses against another outstanding team. And it's going to give both teams a great deal of confidence that they can execute under pressure.
Utah Navy, the poinsettia, the kickoff just a few minutes away. We'll take you there as soon as this one is over. Will 40 minutes be enough here in the Garden?
You've got to be tough just to make a catch.
Sam Young. Got it! What a big shot for the junior. Young now with 15.
Boy, a pick and pop. And Sam Young got his feet set. That's a play a year ago he wouldn't have been able to make.
Final minute of regulation. Henderson ties it up.
Boy, the switch by Pittsburgh. And what a great shot over the outstretched arm of Mike Cook. A big-time play.
in answer to a big-time play.
What a furious finish here in New York. What a sensational last 5 or 6 minutes to this one. Everybody standing here at MSG. It will stay with Pitt. 40 seconds on the game clock, 19 on the shot clock.
Boy, a few plays ago, Paulus thought he knocked it off of Sam Young. There he thought he knocked it off of Ramon and didn't get either call. Pittsburgh very fortunate.
Into the hands of Ramon. Can they get Blair a touch?
He's going to have to be more active. Yeah. He's just standing there. Now Fields, this is the guy they want the ball with because he doesn't make many mistakes.
Nelson on him, five to shoot. The kick to the corner, Cook! Rebound Duke. The shot clock turned off. They've got a timeout if they want it.
And they're going to call it. They're going to try to get it right across half court and then call it because they have not been able to get very much instinctively. And Mike Krzyzewski wants to diagram something, get everybody on the same page, and then send them out there with an opportunity to win the game.
What an electric atmosphere here in the second half of this game. A sold-out Madison Square Garden with the Duke fans outnumbering the Pittsburgh fans, and there have been some great plays down the stretch.
Sam Young with the pick and pop. What a big-time shot that is. Under pressure, and then Gerald Henderson, the turnaround jumper. That is a difficult shot from about 12 feet fading away. He got the switch. Wasn't able to get to the basket and made a big time. It's been big time play after big time play.
We're tied at 58. Duke's been making big time plays in the month of December when they play a lot of tough non-conference games for many years. It has been 7 years since they lost a game in the month of December. If you're Mike Krzyzewski, what are you looking for out of this huddle?
Well, I think you're looking to try to get something off the dribble, to try to spread the floor, whether it's dribble handoffs or try to get a run-out ball screen. You're going to try to get something going to the basket after letting a little time run off. You probably want to get something started around, I'd say, 10. And try to give yourself time for maybe a tip-in or an offensive rebound, but not enough time for Pittsburgh to take it the other way. But you have to be strong with the ball because if you get fouled, you can shoot free throws with the chance to win this ball game. So it's very important, first of all, the inbounds pass. You got to make a good inbounds pass in order to get the ball in and set it up.
Football is next. Utah and Navy coming up as soon as this game is over. Duke has made their last four shots, three of them by Gerald Henderson. Jamie Luck is trying to get the Blue Devils out of the floor. The timeout is over.
What's really important here, Dan, if a shot ultimately does go up, you've got to make sure that you box out. One of the ways you can get beat in an end-of-game situation isn't the initial shot. It's a tip-in because you didn't box out in a scramble situation.
Shire, the handoff to Henderson.
Dribble weave, ball screen.
7 seconds left. Henderson on the drive. No! Put back, no! Overtime!
And Duke had an opportunity, not just on the initial shot, but we talked about the tip-in, and Kyle Singler was right there for the tip-in and couldn't get it to go. Boy, what a great defensive stand by Pittsburgh. And you can see Singler having Ramon on him after this drive. Ramon comes off. I'm not used to boxing out. Boy, what a great opportunity for a tip-in. Tough drive, the bump. Gilbert Brown does a nice job of coming over, and Kyle Singler had a great opportunity. What a game!
That close to winning it for the Blue Devils. We are headed to overtime when we come back.
Pressure's on. Here's the situation. You've got two children. College tuition is in sight. Retirement is breathing down your neck.
Who do you go to in the clutch? Over 65 million customers rely on us when their money is on the line. Insurance, investments, retirement. AIG, the strength to be there.
Welcome back to New York City. What a night of basketball here at Madison Square Garden. Holiday Hoops presented by Kay Jewelers with Doris Burke, Jay Bilas. I'm Dan Shulman. We are headed to overtime. Two top 10 teams, two unbeaten teams. Meanwhile, the football game, Utah Navy, has started over on ESPN Classic. as we go to the extra session here in the Garden. Nobody is fouled out, although Nelson and Singler, who came that close to winning it for Duke, are each playing with four fouls. Juan Blair engaged in a lot of physical play tonight, just the way the young man likes it. He has an impressive double-double, but on the other side also missed a lot of free throws, committed a couple of fouls he'd love to have back. Gerald Henderson has been explosive tonight. And the last 5 or 6 minutes, we've made the heavyweight fight analogy a lot tonight, and it sure felt like that.
Just big play after big play. And there were so many missed opportunities in that second half for Pittsburgh, but you've got to give them an enormous amount of credit for sticking with it. A tremendous amount of mental toughness from the Panthers.
Pittsburgh was down double figures for much of the night, rallied to take the lead, and now we head into overtime as the Blue Devils will go to the line. And you can see in the upper right corner of your screen the football game underway and airing currently over on ESPN Classic. That foul on Blair, number 4 on the big guy for the Panthers.
But even though there are players in this game that have 4 fouls, you cannot back off. You just have to be smart. And Duke really tried to spread the floor in order to get that driving opportunity. And here's where DeMarcus Nelson's free throw percentage and free throw problems can really hurt you. I mean, he gets to the line so much, and he's worked so hard on it, just not able to knock down free throws at a high rate.
It's 1 of 2. Duke leads by a point. Fields bringing it up for Pitt, defended by Nelson. Blair and Singler have it matched up against one another for most of the night. And again, in the half court, Jay, Blair doesn't move a whole lot in the first few seconds of the possession.
Probably a good no call on the part of the officials there. Both play. Could have called it on either one of them.
Cook. And it's going to go against Pitt. And down on the floor and shaken up. It's a travel on Pitt. And it's Cook shaken up and grabbing his left knee and in a lot of pain.
See, there's so much contact and... oh, the knee just buckled. You could see as he went down. That does not look good. What a difficult situation for a really good player, Mike Cook.
A senior out of Philadelphia, played his first 2 years at East Carolina before transferring to Pittsburgh. Sat out 2 years ago as a transfer. Played last year. A solid contributor for this Panther program.
And Jamie Dixon, you can see right there with him. I mean, that's a head coach that truly cares about his players. You know, they've got the rest of the team in a huddle with the assistant coaches, but he knows how difficult this is. Jamie Dixon has been through injuries himself, but right there with his player. And see, when he makes this plant, he's getting some contact and a little bit of a bump and plants, and you can just see that knee buckle. And you hate to see that happen to any player.
And a building that has been so noisy for much of the night has gone absolutely silent here. And now the Pittsburgh fans are booing. I think it was a Let's Go Duke chant that started, and I think the Pittsburgh fans started booing as if to say, come on, guys, have a little,
yeah, there's something,
a little sensitivity here for Mike Cook.
Yeah, a little more in the game going on.
Yeah.
You can see Mike Cook not only in a lot of pain, but I'm sure can feel that this seems serious.
They will help Cook off the floor as we go back to the studio with Carl Ravitch.
All right, Dan, thank you very much. And obviously a very serious situation there. Pitt fans have Pittsburgh Steelers on their mind as well, with Pittsburgh up 17-14 as they head to the half. 2.5 to play in the first. Roethlisberger having a very good first half. 8 of 10, 200 yards, and 2 touchdowns to Washington.
All right, Carl, in the back here, even with the assistance of a couple of members of the Pittsburgh staff, Mike Cook is barely able to get off the floor, not putting any weight on that left leg. And ever so slowly, they'll take Cook off and into the locker room, and you just hope this is not as serious as it looks like it potentially could be.
Well, anytime you have an injury that appears to be catastrophic, sometimes it can shake up the team. But usually in practice, when somebody goes down with an ankle, knee, whatever it is, you get your team on the other end and get them back playing and practicing. There's nothing they can do to help Mike Cook. They've got to concentrate and focus on playing right now, and that's what Jamie Dixon wants to get his team to do.
Gilbert Brown replaces Cook. Duke by 1 early in the overtime. Henderson absorbs the contact, misses the runner, and another rebound for DeJuan Blair. Give him 18 boards tonight.
Well, this really is a man's game. And when you take the ball to the basket, you better be prepared to absorb a bump. Jamie Dixon calling a timeout, feeling that he might have gotten a 5-second call. And Sam Young is very frustrated right now and upset. The coaching staff having to calm him down.
Now, DeJuan Blair has been a guy, a freshman that we've talked about a lot, kind of introduced to you for those of you who may not have seen him. And he has had a big night somewhere. Ontario Letts, Chevy Troutman, and Donatas Savaskas are watching it smiling.
And very proud. I mean, he's got everything in his game. He leads the team in rebounding. He leads the team in block shots and steals. An outstanding offensive rebounder that has second jump ability. And he's also got an infectious smile and great enthusiasm for the game. The 18 rebounds against anybody is big time. But you put up 18 rebounds in your first trip to Madison Square Garden, that's pretty good.
Yep. He's averaging better than 9 rebounds per game. And still, Mike Cook, they have still been unable to get him where they want to get him. And perhaps I would assume maybe they're trying to bring a cart to put him on because they just can't move him at all. Just no weight on that left leg.
Well, just difficult to watch. Mike Cook is a great kid. You mentioned transferred from East Carolina where he played for Bill Herrien, whose brother Tom Herrien, the former coach at the College of Charleston, is now on Jamie Dixon's staff as an assistant.
So could the Pitt players put that aside for the moment and try to rally to win this game, a game they fought so hard in the second half to get back, take a lead before Duke tied it and then almost won it. The Blue Devils did at the end of regulation. Now we're in overtime.
Well, there's nothing the players can do to help Mike Cook. I mean, they've got to concentrate on what's in front of them, and that's winning a basketball game. The box set trying to isolate Sam Young in the low post.
He's got a size advantage on DeMarcus Nelson. They get it down to Young.
Oh,
he spins to the baseline. And Blair had 2 touches, and then the big guy runs it down in the corner. Brown's got it, and it's going to be a held ball, says Mike Kitts, and it will be pit ball.
Well, Mike Kitts just making that call just to try to keep it from being a scrum situation. What a great move. Drop step by Young. He needs to use the glass here. Use the glass, you get 2 points. That's a very difficult shot to try to get in without using the glass.
Kids throwing bodies around like the Duke and Pitt players have so far tonight. He's getting caught up in it.
Even the referees are physical.
It's a man's game even for the refs tonight. Young again with Paulus on.
We need 3 Green Berets to ref this thing.
This time it goes down. Pitt leads.
Well, we talked about the frustration of Sam Young. Well, he's come out and channeled that on the offensive end with an aggressive move. You talk about letting your instincts take over. That's what Sam Young's done.
And now nearly a turnover, and it will be as a foul is called on Paulus.
Well, probably a good foul by Paulus because Fields was going to have a layup if he didn't stop him there.
Number 3 on Paulus, 2 free throws for Fields.
You see the drive by Nelson. Didn't get any call there on the terrific job by Gilbert Brown. But if Paulus didn't dive in there and take the legs out from under Levance Fields, he would have had a layup.
Fields is 68% free throw shooter on the season, 2 of 2 tonight.
This is where you win ball games in big time arenas, is by knocking free throws down in late game situations.
And again, this is a guy who showed up on campus with confidence and toughness, and he has grown into the role as a leader. Levance Fields, a guy who had an offseason minor scrape with the law, wound up being charged with simple assault after an altercation outside a nightclub. Some community service for Fields, some probation, sat out for a couple of weeks of practice. But if you ask the Pitt program, the players, he's the leader of this team.
He's certainly been a leader tonight. Got an amazing 3.5-to-1 assist turnover ratio. That just doesn't happen.
3-point lead for Pitt. Under 3 minutes to go in overtime. Henderson. And Ramon skies for the rebound.
Well, that was a really difficult shot by Gerald Henderson.
Fields will walk it up the floor, defended by Nelson.
He was really flirting with a 10-second call there. The clock had gotten down to 25.
Ramon
there for the tip-in and couldn't get it to go.
Boy, what a great defensive stand by Pittsburgh. And you can see Singler having Ramon on him after this drive. Ramon comes off him, not used to boxing out. Boy, what a great opportunity for a tip-in. Tough drive, the bump. Gilbert Brown does a nice job of coming over, and Kyle Singler had a great opportunity. What a game!
That close to winning it for the Blue Devils. We are headed to overtime when we come back.
Introducing the Remington Clean Exchange, the only electric shaver featuring a disposable head you never have to clean, and two nano silver foils that reduce irritation. Want a better shave? Change heads. Clean Exchange from Remington, the first name in shaving.
The extreme power of Energizer Lithium, the world's longest lasting AA battery and high tech devices. Energizer, keep going.
Huskers.
No.
Huskers with a Z? No. Ooh, a husk guy.
Take him.
How about with that heart? Husk-heart-ker. No. Brasky guy, brasky pants, brasky man. Bet nobody's...
Nope.
Somebody's got that. You know what? I need to go write some more, and I'll be back. Oh, wait. Excuse me. How about Nebraska? Sorry, dude. Nebraska.
Pop quiz. It's time to register for winter term. But Katie used up most of her scholarships, grants, and federal loans. So how does she get the extra cash for college? A, reffing sumo wrestlers. B, go on a game show. C, be a deodorant sniffer. Or D, call the Strive student loans. The correct answer is D. With an Estrive student loan, you can borrow what you need for your education-related expenses. So forget high-interest credit cards. You can even save money and interest when you add a cosigner with good credit. And you get to choose the way you want to repay, including waiting till after you graduate. Estrive student loans. It's the smart way to borrow. Or you can always be a human sushi roll.
Estrive student loans. Applying is fast and free, so go online to estrive406.com or call 1-800-671-2685 now.
Welcome back to New York City. What a night of basketball here at Madison Square Garden. Holiday Hoops presented by K Jewelers with Doris Burke, Jay Bilas. I'm Dan Shulman. We are headed to overtime. Two top 10 teams, two unbeaten teams. Meanwhile, the football game, Utah Navy, has started over on ESPN Classic as we go to the extra session here in the Garden. Nobody is fouled out, although Nelson and Singler, who came that close to winning it for Duke, are each playing with four fouls. Juan Blair engaged in a lot of physical play tonight, just the way the young man likes it. He has an impressive double-double, but on the other side also missed a lot of free throws, committed a couple of fouls he'd love to have back. Gerald Henderson has been explosive tonight. And the last 5 or 6 minutes, we've made the heavyweight fight analogy a lot tonight, and it sure felt like that.
Just big play after big play. And there were so many missed opportunities in that second half for Pittsburgh, but you've got to give them an enormous amount of credit for sticking with it. A tremendous amount of mental toughness from the Panthers.
Pittsburgh was down double figures for much of the night, rallied to take the lead, and now we head into overtime as the Blue Devils will go to the line. And you can see in the upper right corner of your screen the football game underway and airing currently over on ESPN Classic. That foul on Blair, number 4 on the big guy for the Panthers.
But even though there are players in this game that have 4 fouls, you cannot back off. You just have to be smart. And Duke really tried to spread the floor in order to get that driving opportunity. And here's where DeMarcus Nelson's free throw percentage and free throw problems can really hurt you. I mean, he gets to the line so much, and he's worked so hard on it, just not able to knock down free throws at a high rate.
It's 1 of 2. Duke leads by a point. Fields bringing it up for Pitt, defended by Nelson. Blair and Singler have it matched up against one another for most of the night. And again, in the half court, Jay, Blair doesn't move a whole lot in the first few seconds of the possession.
Probably a good no call on the part of the officials there. Both played. Could have called it on either one of them.
Cook. And it's going to go against Pitt and down on the floor and shaken up. It's a travel on Pitt, and it's Cook shaken up and grabbing his left knee and in a lot of pain.
See, there's so much contact, and oh, the knee just buckled. You could see as he went down. That does not look good. What a difficult situation for a really good player, Mike Cook.
A senior out of Philadelphia, played his first 2 years at East Carolina before transferring to Pittsburgh. Sat out 2 years ago as a transfer, played last year. A solid contributor for this Panther program.
And Jamie Dixon, you can see right there with him. I mean, that's a head coach that truly cares about his players. You know, they've got the rest of the team in a huddle with the assistant coaches, but he knows how difficult this is. Jamie Dixon has been through injuries himself, but right there with his player. See, when he makes this plant, he's getting some contact and a little bit of a bump and plants, and you can just see that knee buckle. And you hate to see that happen to any player.
And a building that has been so noisy for much of the night has gone absolutely silent here. And now the Pittsburgh fans are booing. I think it was a Let's Go Duke chant that started, and I think the Pittsburgh fans started booing as if to say, come on, guys, have a little,
yeah, there's something,
have a little sensitivity here for Mike
more,
Cook.
Yeah, a little more in the game going on.
Yeah.
You can see Mike Cook not only in a lot of pain, but I'm sure can feel that this seems serious.
They will help Cook off the floor as we go back to the studio with Carl Ravitch. Carl, and back here, even with the assistance of a couple of members of the Pittsburgh staff, Mike Cook is barely able to get off the floor, not putting any weight on that left leg. And ever so slowly, they'll take Cook off and into the locker room, and you just hope this is not as serious as it looks like it potentially could be.
Well, anytime you have an injury that appears to be catastrophic, sometimes it can shake up the team. But usually in practice, when somebody goes down with an ankle, knee, whatever it is, you get your team on the other end and get them back playing and practicing. There's nothing they can do to help Mike Cook. They've got to concentrate and focus on playing right now, and that's what Jamie Dixon wants to get his team to do.
Gilbert Brown replaces Cook. Duke by one early in the overtime. Henderson absorbs the contact, misses the runner, and another rebound for DeJuan Blair. Give him 18 boards tonight.
Well, this really is a man's game. And when you take the ball to the basket, you better be prepared to absorb a bump. Jamie Dixon calling a timeout, feeling that he might have gotten a 5-second call. And Sam Young is very frustrated right now and upset. The coaching staff having to calm him down.
Now, DeJuan Blair has been a guy, a freshman, that we've talked about a lot, kind of introduced to you for those of you who may not have seen him. And he has had a big night somewhere. Ontario Letts, Chevy Troutman, and Donatas Savaskas are watching and smiling.
And very proud. I mean, he's got everything in his game. He leads the team in rebounding. He leads the team in block shots and steals. An outstanding offensive rebounder that has second jump ability. And he's also got an infectious smile and great enthusiasm for the game. 18 rebounds against anybody is big time. But you put up 18 rebounds in your first trip to Madison Square Garden, that's pretty good.
Yep. He's averaging better than 9 rebounds per game. And still, Mike Cook, they have still been unable to get him where they want to get him. And perhaps I would assume maybe they're trying to bring a cart to put him on because they just can't move him at all. Just no weight on that left leg.
Well, just difficult to watch. Mike Cook is a great kid. You mentioned transferred from East Carolina where he played for Bill Herrien, whose brother Tom Herrien, the former coach at the College of Charleston, is now on Jamie Dixon's staff as an assistant.
So could the Pitt players put that aside for the moment and try to rally to win this game, a game they fought so hard in the second half to get back, take a lead before Duke tied it and then almost won it. The Blue Devils did at the end of regulation. Now we're in overtime.
Well, there's nothing the players can do to help Mike Cook. I mean, they've got to concentrate on what's in front of them, and that's winning a basketball game. With
box set trying to isolate Sam Young in the low post.
He's got a size advantage on DeMarcus Nelson. They get it down to Young. Oh, he spins to the baseline. And Blair had two touches, and then the big guy runs it down in the corner. Brown's got it. And it's going to be a held ball, says Mike Kitts, and it will be pit ball.
Well, Mike Kitts just making that call just to try to keep it from being a scrum situation. What a great move. Drop step by Young. He needs to use the glass here. Use the glass, you get 2 points. That's a very difficult shot to try to get in without using the glass.
My kids throwing bodies around like the Duke and Pitt players have so far tonight. He's getting caught up in it.
Even the referees are physical.
It's a man's game even for the refs tonight. Young again with Paulus on.
We need three green berets to ref this thing.
This time it goes down. Pitt leads.
Boy, we talked about the frustration of Sam Young. Lee's come out and channeled that on the offensive end with an aggressive move. You talk about letting your instincts take over. That's what Sam Young's done.
And now nearly a turnover, and it will be as a foul is called on Paulus.
Well, probably a good foul by Paulus because Fields was going to have a layup if he didn't stop him there.
Number three on Paulus, two free throws for Fields.
You can see the drive by Nelson. Didn't get any call there on the terrific job by Gilbert Brown, but if Paulus didn't dive in there and take the legs out from under Levance Fields, he would have had a layup.
Fields is 68% free throw shooter on the season, 2 of 2 tonight.
This is where you win ball games in big time arenas, is by knocking free throws down in late game situations.
And again, this is a guy who showed up on campus with confidence and toughness, and he has grown into the role as a leader. Levance Fields, a guy who had an offseason minor scrape with the law, wound up being charged with simple assault after an altercation outside a nightclub. Some community service for Fields, some probation, sat out for a couple of weeks of practice. But if you ask the Pitt program, the players, he's the leader of this team.
He's certainly been a leader tonight. He's got an amazing 3.5-to-1 assist turnover ratio. That just doesn't happen.
3-point lead for Pitt. Under 3 minutes to go in overtime. Henderson.
Tough shot.
And Ramon skies for the rebound.
That was a really difficult shot by Gerald Henderson.
Fields will walk it up the floor, defended by Nelson.
He was really flirting with a 10-second call there. The clock had gotten down to 25.
Ramon trying to turn the corner. Fields baseline. Through the hands of Biggs, and back come the Blue Devils. Henderson.
Oh.
And before the block by Brown, I think we've got a foul down low on Ramon.
That's exactly who it's on. But how about the block up top? You know, Levance Fields with the turnover, and you could see the contact, but making sure that it wasn't in any way, shape, or form going to be a 3-point opportunity is the freshman athlete, Gilbert Brown.
Maybe these schools should play more often. First time in 28 years that they have met.
As long as you got a good ice bath afterwards and a cut man in the corner.
Paulus needed it early. Henderson misses the free throw as Blair checks back in. 15 points, 20 rebounds. Henderson 0-for-3 from the line tonight.
And Blair hasn't dished out many assists, but he's dished out about 15 bruises.
Here comes McClure for Henderson. Little offense defense right now for Duke. So Pitt with the ball and a 2-point lead. And again, Fields happy to walk the ball up the floor.
Looks like they're going to try to set up in one of their box sets. And see if they can't get something isolated with Young in the post.
McClure working hard defending him.
Well, they needed to give it to him. He was open. Yeah. Feeding the post, a little bit of a lost art.
Looking on the other side now for Blair. Can't get it into him. Shot clock down into single digits.
A nice pass.
Brown wide open. Rebound Nelson.
Well, can't ask for a better shot.
After Pittsburgh struggled so badly taking care of the ball early, Fields has made some great decisions down the stretch. Nelson takes the bump and is going to the line.
And Blair on the foul. What a finish. The great crossover, taking it to the other side, and he fouls out a big-time rebounder shot blocker in Dewan Blair. Boy, that's body control, that's strength, and that's finishing ability of a senior. Right underneath to the other side of the rim to avoid the blocked shot. What a big-time play.
So a critical loss for Pitt as the Duke bench explodes. Mike Cook's already been injured out of the game. Dewan Blair now has fouled out after a monster night on the glass.
Are you one of the millions of people who think you just can't learn a second language? The problem isn't that you can't learn. It's that you've been using the wrong method.
Well, thanks to our breakthrough software called Rosetta Stone, learning a new language is now incredibly easy and a whole lot faster.
I've probably learned more in the first 2 weeks than I have in months of taking formal classes.
Unlike traditional methods that require hours of tedious translation and memorization, with Rosetta Stone, you're actively engaged in each lesson. From the very beginning, you'll see real-life images and hear native speakers.
El caballo está saltando.
This powerful combination teaches you to think in a new language, not memorize, so speaking comes naturally. You learn far more easily and more quickly.
I've used a lot of different mediums, the books, the tapes, and it just, bar none, it's the best one that I've ever used.
I was one of those people who thought they could not learn a language, and I needed to learn a language for my job, so I needed to learn Spanish. And I learned Spanish quickly, and I did it through Rosetta Stone.
Rosetta Stone is so fast and effective, it's used by the U.S. State Department, NASA, the FBI, and top Fortune 500 companies, and is the world's leading language learning software.
It's almost like having your own person there teaching you, your own private tutor, who is just very relaxed in your home with you, sitting there teaching you the language.
Rosetta Stone is the fastest way to learn a new language. And to prove it, we'll send you our amazing demo CD absolutely free when you call. There's no obligation to buy. Right away, you'll see for yourself just how fast and easy it is to learn a new language with Rosetta Stone.
This really is a great program.
I believe that you can learn any language with this program.
If you're serious about learning a language, there's no easier way to do it than with Rosetta Stone.
Call the number on your screen now and see for yourself why Rosetta Stone is the fastest way to learn a language, guaranteed.
Matt Carl, who knows how long we're going to need to finish off this one. Already in overtime with a minute 36 to go. The game is tied at 62 as the senior DeMarcus Nelson steps to the line. An athletic up and under scoop layup that fouled out Blair. Nelson looking for the three-point play.
And Pittsburgh right now with a little bit of a depleted lineup. Mike Cook with the injury. Dewan Blair having fouled out. And they're relying on a freshman in Gilbert Brown out on the floor. And Tyrell Biggs, who has not been a load carrier for this team.
Fields probing. Finds Young for three. Biggs with a rebound in traffic. And a travel on Fields.
Just going a little bit too fast.
Fields complaining. Jamie Dixon is not.
Well, that's one to catch and pass the ball. When you get an offensive rebound, oftentimes everybody gets congested into the lane and sucked down inside that three-point line. That's a great opportunity to shoot a wide-open three.
Each team with a timeout, double bonus both ways. Duke with the arrow. Henderson back in as Henderson and McClure have been subbing in for one another depending on whether or not Duke has the ball.
I think Duke's going to try to get some action, maybe some handoffs and a ball screen to try to drive it again.
And Mike Krzyzewski wants to use his last timeout. Well, tomorrow marks the 50th anniversary of one of Pitt's individual scoring accomplishments. December the 21st, 1957, Don Henin set the Panthers' single-game scoring record of 45 points against Duke. The game went two overtimes. Pitt won 87-84. These two schools had not met since 1979 before tonight. And again, this is what's great about non-conference play, seeing schools from different parts of the country meeting, and in this case, on a neutral floor.
Yeah, and they're two powerhouse programs that are great teams this year and have a chance. I mean, both teams have a chance not only in their league,
but nationally. This is a great test for each team, but it's a physical test
really
as well,
been.
And it's been a test of mental toughness. And both teams have answered the bell.
Both teams unbeaten. Both teams 10-0, and there's more great basketball action coming your way Saturday. Check out this lineup. Five games beginning with number 4, unbeaten Georgetown, against number 2 and unbeaten Memphis. Noon Eastern right here on ESPN. Tennessee and Xavier should be great. Stanford takes on Texas Tech in Dallas. Texas, they're still unbeaten against Michigan State at the Palace of Auburn Hills. And then the Bush Bragging Rights game with Illinois taking on Missouri. Pittsburgh, an impressive comeback in the second half. They got it to overtime, but they've lost Cook to injury, and Blair has fouled out. Now Duke turns it over, and Pittsburgh can reclaim the lead.
Just not strong enough with the ball. Coming off that curl, showing it. And anytime you show the ball against Pittsburgh, they're going to take it from you.
It'll be Fields quarterbacking. It'll be Fields driving. Offensive foul.
Wow. It looked like Fields skirted that. Now, Singler did a great job of coming over from the weak side and trying to establish position, but I thought that Fields was able to skirt that. That was close. Close. But a great play by Kyle Singler to lay his body on the line. He kind of came into him there. That's an awfully tough call for an official to make.
So now, Jay, the shot clock's turned off. 34 and a half seconds to go. Duke's got the ball in a one-point lead.
Well, you can get an initial trap. You don't need to foul.
Shire gets out of it.
Wow, what a play by Henderson. Now you have to foul.
And they do.
Boy, what a play by Gerald Henderson to keep that ball from being stolen. Tipped it to himself. And Pittsburgh got exactly what they wanted. Was a trap on the sideline using the two defenders, and then the sideline as a third defender, and they let Duke get out of the trap.
And Singler, although he's a freshman, probably not the guy you want to foul if you're Pitt. 82%, and he knocked down some big ones, I know, out in Maui, and he's knocked down some big ones all year.
Yeah, this guy's he's a freshman in name only.
Yeah.
I mean, he is wise beyond his years.
3 of 4 tonight. Even if he makes them both, it's a one possession game. Nolan Smith and David McClure into the game for Duke. Paulus and Henderson out. Better defenders coming in now for the Blue Devils. Now,
Pittsburgh doesn't need to be in any rush, make or miss, by Singler. They just need to be strong. And
he got it. Used the entire rim. Pitt does have a timeout. Down by 2.
Now, Jamie Dixon wants a timeout.
And he'll take it with 16 seconds to go.
He wants to script the shot that he wants. They've had good success running that run-out ball screen, but they don't have DeJuan Blair to set it. So you would think that they're going to try to do something that's going to involve Sam Young, maybe a pick and pop, something where he can put the ball on the floor and use his athleticism, and also Levance Fields. But if they can position Ronald Ramon for an open shot where he can get his feet set, that's another good option.
Well, Pitt is 10-0 on the season. They've won at Duquesne, at Washington. They've beaten Oklahoma State. Their next game is a tough one. They'll scatter for the holidays but come back and practice on Christmas Day. They've got a game on the 29th on ESPN2 at Dayton. Dayton, a very good team. And then before you know it, starting with Villanova on January the 6th, into Big East play. And the Big East, like the ACC, is going to be a bear again this season. Annually, two of the top conferences in the country.
Yeah, there's never anything easy in the Big East. And Pittsburgh they have played so well in league games and Big East tournament games, and Duke has got its handful in a very good ACC this year. I still think North Carolina the best team in the Atlantic Coast Conference, but every game's going to be a fist fight for Duke as well.
Duke is off until January the 6th. Their players will get about a week off for Christmas after the game tonight. Let's go to Carl Ravage. Back here in New York, Carl, 16 seconds to go. Pittsburgh has the ball, down by 2, out of timeouts, in a game that has featured more bumps and bruises and cuts and scrapes than you could count.
Well, Pittsburgh toward the end of a clock. They like to run an open set and get a run out ball screen. Here it comes, involving Sam Young, but didn't get anything out of it.
Down to 7 seconds. Fields for three.
Oh!
Duke out of timeouts. Shire. Shire again. Oh, it would have counted. But Pittsburgh wins here in the Garden, 65-64. Levance Fields with the three to win it for the Panthers.
This is the most wonderful time of the year. 30-